All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get started. This is the City of Desert Hot Springs, a regular meeting of the City Council, and the City Council serving as the successor agency to the Redevelopment Agency Board. For January 17th, 2017, this is our 5:30 presentation period. And we actually are going to have two presentations tonight. One is the selection of the Mayor Pro Tem. I have a presentation to give, and then we're going to have a presentation, a verbal presentation by the police chief on the actions that were taken today in our city. First, I would like the City Council to join me in the front, please. So each year the mayor gets to pick a mayor pro tem. That is a person that fills in for the mayor whenever the mayor is not available to go to different events and or take over the chair of the meeting if the mayor needs to recuse himself. This last year was Councilmember Joe McKee, and he did a fantastic job. And I wanted to recognize him and say thank you for your service to my office and helping me through this year. He always lended an ear when needed. And I just wanted to recognize that with a certificate of recognition, the mayor and the City Council of the City of Desert Hot Springs hereby honors Joe McKee in appreciation of your service to the City of Desert Hot Springs Mayor Pro Tem 2016. It is official. We're also going to mount this for him so he can hang it in his office, or we're going to mount it on a. And we're so. Oh, melt it? No, we're not going to melt it. Mount. Yeah, mount it so that he can hang it over his bed or wherever you want. One thing before you guys leave. And it is ceremonial that the City Council then ratifies what the mayor chooses for the next year. And with her experience on the City Council in the past and being able to take on the role of basically the vice mayor of this community, I'm asking that the City Council ratify Yvonne Parks as Mayor Pro Tem. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
That said,
the new mayor pro tem for the year 2017 will be Yvonne.
Well, how did you know that was going to happen?
I took a chance. It was $5.
While he's getting up here, I'm going to say something. I think I lent more than my ear to him actually during this year. And one of the things that was very positive about it, even though we at times don't see eye to eye, I think we kept a good relationship, and I do appreciate that.
Thank you. During the break, ladies and gentlemen, during the break, thanks. We're gonna take one more moment, and what we'd like to do is ask our police chief to give a report on Operation Sandstorm.
Correct.
I've got it right.
And actually, if I may, just so she can get out of here and we don't charge the city overtime, Nicole, could you stand up? I would like to introduce everybody to my new administrative assistant, Nicole Sanchez. So she will be at extension 704. If anybody is interested in reaching out to me, and that's for everybody even listening at home, if anybody is listening at home. She comes to us with a great amount of experience, even for her young age. We're very happy to have her. So she's fitting right in. And we actually put her, did you want to say anything, Nicole? I always offer and she never does. We even put her to work today out at Operation Sandstorm. So what this was, and Nicole, if you want to take off, you can.
Thank you.
So since AB 109 passed, passed and was signed by the governor, individuals who are allegedly nonviolent offenders that normally would be sentenced to prison are no longer sentenced to prison. And when they would be released, they would normally be supervised by state parole, and they are no longer being supervised by state parole. All of that responsibility has been pushed on to the counties, and to some extent, the cities. So over the course of the last number of weeks, the police department has been working with the PAC team, and the PAC is post accountability and compliance team. So they monitor these individuals. We have about 112 of those individuals within the city and immediately surrounding the city, Sky Valley or other unincorporated areas. And so we had decided, we thought it would be a good idea to make a full force effort, zero tolerance, one day compliance check, because these individuals, some of them may go months and without any sort of compliance check to verify that they are doing the terms or following the terms of their probation. And so today, with the help of the county's PAC team, which consists of Coachella Valley, as well as, I'm not sure if it's called the West Valley PAC team, but all the PAC teams in San Bernardino County, California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, the FBI, Border Patrol, ICE, CHP, Cathedral City, Riverside County Sheriff's Department, Coachella Valley Narcotics Task Force, Coachella Valley Gang Task Force, Marietta, Hemet PD, Indio PD, the District Attorney's Gang Intervention Team, as well as the gang team from Homeland Security and officers from the Desert Hot Springs, did compliance checks on all 112 of those individuals in our area. Of course, we're very happy to report that that the large majority of those, there were some that were not home and that we did not locate, but over 70 that we did were in compliance. And for those of you that were in compliance, we do thank you very much as a police department and as a community. There were 29 who were not in compliance. And we did have zero tolerance. Those 30 or 29 were arrested, and some were later released with a notice to appear, a handful of those. The rest will be done with flash incarceration, which is where they will go back to state prison for a 30-day stretch to remind them that if they're not behaving themselves, these are the consequences. And we have found these types of operations to be very effective. In the scheme of things, I guess those violations, some people would consider them minor. We did have one with a weapons charge that we located, so he'll be charged with a felony. There were a number of misdemeanor as well as felony warrants for these individuals who were out of compliance already, and then a handful, I don't remember the exact numbers, we're still working on mining that data of who actually had a failure in their terms. And we'll have that information out in a press release soon. But it was quite a long day, but I think a very productive day. And, you know, I would say this as well, because a lot of people consider these things minor, and sometimes we do as well. But the problem, if we don't deal with these minor issues, as I refer to them, it's like a naughty child that we see out here every Wednesday, that they're just not being held accountable for their actions. And if we can get these individuals early on in their release and remind them, you know, hey, you have a responsibility to be productive and follow the rules, then we're hopefully not going to have to deal with them later at the back end. And it's no secret that we have had an increase in, since AB 109, an increase in property crimes and an astronomical increase in auto thefts. I believe last year our auto thefts were up 25%. I've talked to some agencies, their auto theft over 300% increase. So these operations, you know, are very successful. The other one that was arrested that was not counted in the 30 was wanted out of Arkansas for a parole violation for robbery and a probation violation for a residential burglary. And to that end, I would actually like to thank the LGBT community, because we had gotten reports that this particular individual was victimizing people in the LGBT community, but the victims did not want to come forward and report it. So we don't have any substantiated crime that they had occurred. We knew about the warrants. There were individuals who were giving us information that we had actually passed along to another law enforcement agency that they were not able to locate them. And then yesterday, the LGBT community got hold of us again. And that one particular individual knows who she is. Thank you very much. I was in Kansas City, as most of you know. She had called me, gave me the address where we could find her, and that was the first house that we went to today and arrested her on. And she will be extradited back to Arkansas and completely removed out of our community. And I think that's all I have. And I'll be happy to answer any questions. Oh, just on another note, out of all of those agencies, there were 160 law enforcement officers in the community today that helped us out. And a special thanks to Michael Kelleher, Yucca Valley, and a couple of other people who I know want to remain anonymous, so I will not issue their name, who actually came and provided us lunch. A benefactor, if I may, donated hamburgers and hot dogs and buns and condiments to us. And then Grumpy, who's a guy that I know, a chaplain with the Sheriff's Department up in Joshua Tree at San Bernardino County Sheriff's Department. But he also has a great big barbecue that he will come and he's done a couple of barbecues for us at the police department. He came down and fed everybody today that worked the operation, including the fire department speak of the devil, thanks to the chief. We actually, when you got 160 people, kind of rough to cram everybody in here to run a command post. So the fire department was very nice. And just for the cost of hamburgers and hot dogs, let us use their facility. So we would have a command post and a place to brief this morning. So, and with that, the only other thing I have to add, I know we also had, of course, donuts and coffee this morning, and we all know that police like donuts. But I would like to go on record that the fire department ate just as many donuts as we did. So they like them just as much as we do. So, and now I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Mr. McKee.
First of all, it was interesting to wake up this morning and be greeted as we were. I actually had a team that parked in my front yard and blocked the driveway, so I do have a complaint.
Actually, we'll turn that over to code enforcement. We know that is a violation.
It was a sheriff's car, so that you know that it was a problem. All kidding aside, we appreciate what happened. And I want to reiterate the fact that this is just checking on people and making sure they're doing the right thing.
Yes.
And I think that I think that we have talked individually about the fact that I would like to see this be an ongoing thing that was done with a smaller team continuously in the town and continue. And hopefully we can add a few more police and do that.
And I agree with all of that, especially the last part.
Yeah.
And but that is one of the benefits of us being on the PAC team that well, one, we get funded by that at least through this fiscal year through the state. But well worth the money that one guy can bring that many in. And I agree, when we do these in the future, we don't need 160 people, you know, smaller scale that we're able to knock them out. But this, you know, allowed us really to hit every person on one day.
So. And we appreciate everything that's gone on. Thank you very much, Chief.
Mr. Betts?
Yeah, I just wanted thank everybody for their efforts, and Chief, you're doing a really great job, especially putting something like this together for us, and I think this is going to have a lot of ancillary benefit. I did notice there were some Steelers that got away in Kansas City. Anybody PAC team going after them?
We're working on that. That will be more of a covert operation.
Okay. So. Steelers, you know.
I got it. Ms. Parks.
Yes. Thank you. I got all kinds of inquiries. What is going on? There's police everywhere. So I'm glad to hear that it was successful. And as an aside, you know how gung-ho I am for community-based policing. Where are we at in our putting together our community-based policing program?
We're still in the exploratory stages. I shouldn't say still, but I will, of trying actually to devise a plan. I don't want to put something in place just to put something in place. So when we do that, we want to make sure that we have the right people assigned to the right areas doing the right things, you know, for the community.
I would just like to thank you and all the officers that were involved. Thank you.
And please, on behalf of the mayor and the city council, please give them all our best and say thank you for doing such a great job and keeping our community safe and continuing to do this over the years since Operation Falling Sun started. I think this is our fourth or fifth event that they've come back in and helped us clean up help keep these people in compliance. And so it's very important to us, especially after the state of California did what they did on releasing everybody back to the local levels and making it basically our problem. So we appreciate everything you've done, and thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we will recess until 6 o'clock. Good evening, everybody. All right, this is the City of Desert Hot Springs regular meeting of the City Council. The City Council is serving as a successor agency to the Redevelopment Agency Board for January 17th, 2017. This is our regular session at 6 p.m. here at the Carl May Center. Before we begin, we're going to do a couple things. First, I'd like to talk about John Benoit. And I'd like my council to say a few words if they feel if they need to. John Bonet was the 4th District Supervisor for Riverside County. He began his service with the CHP and retired them as a captain, commander?
Commander.
Commanded. Thank you. Oh. Wanted to make sure I got that right. But then he was elected to the school board, Desert Sands. And then elected to the state assembly, elected to the state senate, and then appointed and then elected to the Riverside County Supervisor, 4th District. 64 years old, you just never know. And unfortunately, he came down with a form of cancer that took his life pretty quick. I wanted to say a few words. I was elected in 2007 in a special election. And after the election night, I woke up the next morning to a bunch of congratulations phone calls from local residents and friends and family and some of the council members at that time. But the first person that called me from outside the city was John Benoit. He did not represent our area at the time as assemblyman, but I pick up the phone and I hear Scott Mattis. I said, yes. And I hear, congratulations on becoming a council member for the city of Desert Hot Springs. I said, thank you. And I said, who is this? He says, this is Assemblyman John Benoit. You might not know me because I don't represent you, but we pretty much mirror, my district mirrors your district, and we're right next door, and I'm in the Coachella Valley, and I just wanted to say congratulations. And from that day on, I was just so proud to know him. You did not want to cross him if he was working on a political issue, but you wanted him to be your best friend when it came to politics because he knew how to do it right. And it's a sad loss for Riverside County to see him go like he did, but it was a great memorial service last Tuesday for his legacy and what he did for this Riverside County. So tonight, after the council members, if they want to say a few words, they're more than welcome. Our invocation will take place next, and we'll take a moment of silence at that time. Would anybody else like to say anything? We'll just start at that end and we'll work our way back down.
John Benoit was truly nonpartisan, and he treated me very well, even though we could disagree on things. He was a gentleman, and I think basically emulated what you would expect for someone that was a district supervisor. He listened. At times he would agree. At times he would explain to you why he couldn't do anything, or he would just disagree with what you were saying. But you always felt that his heart was in the right place, that he was trying to do the best for all the citizens in this district, no matter who they were. And he pushed these last few years for a number of things that have come into the city. He was very concerned about the fact that our building was empty for a while just south of Vaughn's, and worked very hard to get the services in there. He made sure that the new building on Pearson that's going to have 120 new jobs from the county is moving along as quickly as possible. I just appreciate the fact that when we were negotiating for a few things, he would work with you and commit to doing things that were good for the city. And he will be missed.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Yes, I first became acquainted with.
They can't hear your mic's not on. Oh, I'm sorry. Maybe it was too far away from you.
Can you hear me now? Mm-hmm. Anyway, I first became acquainted with John when he was on the school board. And he was always very, very supportive of getting things done with the kids. And then when he moved on to assembly and then Senate and then the county supervisor, he was always very, very willing to work with cities like Desert Hot Springs. Whatever we needed, he would look to see what he could do to help us. And my heart goes out to his wife, Cheryl, who I know misses him dearly, because they were very, very close. And it was just, he was just diagnosed in November and died less than a month later, or just over a month later. So it was, I'm sure, a shock to the entire family, and my heart goes out to each and every one of them.
Councilmember Zavala.
I would just like to say, may he be blessed with peace for all his years of service to the community and to the people of the Coachella Valley. And my heart goes out to him and his family. And I hope that, you know, we can all share that memory and relish all the good that he did for everyone.
Councilmember Betts?
Yeah, I think the mayor's comments. He reached out to me in 2007 when I first got elected, which I was thought that was impressive. And I know you had a history of doing that with other electeds around the valley. I've served with him on a couple of boards and commissions. Had quite a bit of time talking to him when he's in the assembly in the state, just sharing. He shared, very approachable guy. He shared those experiences up there. And I think but you could see that he really loved the supervisor's position, and it's just very, very sad that that was cut short. I serve on a commission with his son, Ben Benoit, and you could just see that that type of thing just tears you up as a family member, and they were close. So anyhow, like everybody else has said, it's just, you know, just enjoy your time while you're here. You just don't know how quickly it can end, and just, you know, keep plowing away and do the best you can.
With that said, we're going to have everybody stand. I'm sorry? Reverend Bruce Montgomery from Pastor of Grace Church, he'll be giving the invocation and will be followed by the Pledge of Allegiance or the flag presentations by Troop 1606.
And let me just add, as a citizen of Desert Hot Springs, my great admiration and respect for John Benoit. We met at countless ribbon cuttings, groundbreakings. As a photographer, I love taking his photo. He was very photogenic. Always, anyone that wanted to pose with him, I never heard him say no. He was too busy for that. And something else we had in common, we would admire each other's hats, both of us being hat wearers. Let's begin with a moment of silence honoring John J. Benoit. And as it's the day after Martin Luther King Day, let's take another moment just to remember and honor the memory of a great civil rights leader, Martin Luther King. Heavenly Father, in our nation, which is so characterized by mean, ugly spirits, rancor, anger, fear, bitterness, disunity, I thank you for men like Martin Luther King and John Benoit, who worked for the greater good, not their own interests, who had the courage to do what was necessary. Lord, I pray for our nation, for our city, for our city council, that we would be men and women of peace, unity, cooperation, mutual respect, with receptivity to others' opinions. I pray that even this evening, as our council deliberates on things that affect us all, that you would give them a spirit of mutual respect and unity. Give them wisdom, give them discernment as they hear different opinions to choose the right one, that they would lead and guide us in a way that would help everyone and honor and glorify you. In the name of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, I pray, amen.
Amen.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Troop 1606. All right, City Attorney, report on closed session.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. We have no reportable action for this evening.
All right, this is going to be the approval of the agenda. Any items on the consent calendar you'd like to pull, we'd ask that you do now before the approval of the agenda.
So moved.
There's a motion to approve the agenda with no items pulled from consent calendar? Yes?
Just for the purpose of recusal, I'm going to recuse from the recognized obligation payment schedule. I don't know if there's anything on there, but
okay.
Just to be safe.
Duly noted. Mr. Betts will be recusing from item 21. Any other comments? All right, please vote. Actually, when it comes up on the screen. Maker of the motion, second, please vote.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you, Mr. City Clerk. We'll now move on to item the public comments. At this time, pursuant to the Brown Act, any persons may comment on matters of general interest within the subject matter jurisdiction of the City Council not listed on the agenda. Under the Brown Act, the City Council shall not take action on or discuss matters raised during public comment portions of the agenda that are not listed on the agenda. Comments are limited to the first 10 speakers at 3 minutes per speaker. Speakers may not yield their time to others without the consent of the mayor. All comments are to be directed to the City Council and shall be devoid of any personal attacks. Members of the public are expected to maintain professional, courteous decorum during public comments. Our first public comment is Jeff Horton, followed by Isaac Ron.
Good evening, Mayor Mattis, council members, staff, and citizens of Desert Hot Springs. My name is Jeff Horton. I'm the chairman for the Veterans Committee here in Desert Hot Springs. I have a few announcements. The Vietnam Mobile Wall will be coming to Desert Hot Springs in June, preferably probably into mid-month. We are looking for sponsors to donate to this great memorial for our Vietnam veterans. A lot of Vietnam veterans cannot fly to Washington, D.C. to see the original. So this mobile wall makes it easier for our veterans to see their fallen brothers' names and remember their history of their deployment. Please help us help them to try to close loose ends and memories of the fallen. This is a very therapeutic for our combat veterans, their families, and friends. The event will take place at the Mission Springs Water District Park located behind the Agua Soleil Hotel on Palm Drive. So it's very important that if we can get donors to donate money to the City of Desert Hot Springs, they have an account that is established to take those donations, it would be greatly appreciated. Also, if you find flags in Desert Hot Springs that are ripped, torn, tattered, or however dismembered that they are, you can contact the local VFW at 760-671-6185 to report that so we can try to get those flags fixed. Or just ask for me, Jeff Horton. The VFW Post 1534 by the B-Bar Ranch will be holding a fundraising event for the Vietnam Wall. All food donations that are accumulated will go to the Vietnam Wall coming here to Desert Hot Springs. I will be posting more events later on this next couple months to be able to give you the time and dates of those events that so you can participate there at the Post. We have great food down there. Well, I'm the cook down there, so yeah, of course. Also, there will be a veteran stand down sponsored by the Elks Lodge coming up in the March timeframe. I'm trying to find the time and dates for that. It's a very good event. I'm going to try to see how much I can get involved with that event by bringing other sponsored organizations in here to be able to partake on that and make it run a little bit more smoother. The VFW was successful for the December toy drive. We had over 68 toys and blankets to veterans and families that were donated to them, as well as Desert Hot Springs residents. Thank you everyone who helped with the donations of the toys and blankets and the money to make the event possible. Troop 1606 was there present. They had their troop master play the role of Santa, which was outstanding, and we had cookie decorating going on. It was a very successful event.
Got to wrap up, Jeff. Your 3 minutes are up. Got to wrap up real quick.
Oh, apologize. Also, the JROTC program is having a drill competition on Saturday the 21st at 0700 hours until 1400 if you want to come down to participate and watch what's going on. That would be gladly appreciated from you. I'll also be the judge at that event. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Isaac Garon, followed by Bruce Montgomery.
Good Good evening, Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, City Council. Monday, January 16th of 2017, which was yesterday, we had our Martin Luther King commemorative peace and unity walk. We had a very successful event. I would like to thank all of you for coming to the event. It was very touching, very moving. Next year, we're going to have the fourth annual Martin Luther King Peace and Unity Walk on Monday, January 15th of 2018, and we would like to invite all of you there. We appreciate everything that you did to help us get that put together, and I look forward to seeing you next year. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a great event. Good job. Bruce Montgomery, followed by Nicole Vandale.
Hello, council, staff. On a different note, that's a pun, we have two musical events I would like to invite the community to. The first one is next Sunday, the 22nd, at Christ Lutheran Church. I believe it begins at 4 p.m., and I believe it's not just dueling, but three harpsichordists. I love that movie that has the dueling banjos in it. This is dueling harpsichord, so I am planning to attend. Looking forward to that. And then a good friend of mine has been here a couple of times, and about 3 years ago, he was here last, Sam Rotman, who is an international concert pianist, both bachelor's and master's from Juilliard. He is a member of the Auguste D. Juilliard Society at the Juilliard School, and he is going to be coming, and he's going to be giving a concert on a Tuesday night. Strange night, but he plays over 110 concerts in 10 countries. When he called me 4 months ago and said, I'm going to be in the LA area, I have Tuesday open, I said, come. And so you're all invited. I placed in the dais one for each person. There's some back there. Again, it's January 31st, Tuesday at 6 p.m. at Grace Church. Sam Rotman, a Juilliard-trained classical pianist. You will certainly enjoy both of these events. Thank you.
Thank you. Nicole Vandale, followed by Mike Picardi. After Mike Picardi, I have John Peterson, and I have no one else in the queue. If you're here to speak in public comments, please fill out a blue sheet in the back and give it to the city clerk. This is the second call.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
I don't know if I can look up at you. I'm on a defibrillator, so don't freak out. I don't know if you know me that well yet. I play with you on Twitter. The Steelers won, by the way. Sorry. And I was thinking about that symbology. Because, you know, water is life to these bodies. And I didn't know how to say FTP, except to say it out loud in a public place, and that's what the kids need to learn. That when you are so upset and you can't even look at you and thank you for switching spots. Thank you for switching your positions. I don't see real well when I don't wear glasses. And it's very helpful when I do stuff like this because my heart can't take the negativity on this planet with the water and what we're doing to it. Every cell is connected, say the scientists. I believed my science teachers. Sorry, still do. Why are you recusing yourself, and don't answer me now, darling, for 21? Because I didn't understand that. And while I probably won't be here because it's so down in the agenda, if you could explain that so that me, as the newbie in the room, gets it. Thank you. Thank you for having the Dr. King celebration. I said what I said as a mother who can say whatever she needs to get the attention of those she believes is listening to her. And FTP is very popular to get attention. I thank the parents of the children who stood there and didn't have to leave for standing behind somebody they know a little bit better and know she's got a reason for everything that I say out loud. Thank you.
Thank you. There's a point of personal privilege that the mayor can honor, and because a question was given directly to a council member, I'd like to give that to Mr. Betts to answer that question.
Thanks, and I'm glad you brought that up. Sometimes things get to be routine up here and you don't fully explain. There's a list of obligations of the redevelopment agency. It's a big, long list. And the rules are, if anything is within 500 feet of somewhere where you have a financial interest, you're required to recuse. So what's the phrase? Out of an abundance of caution and not knowing what was on that list that might be within that 500 feet, it was going to pass anyhow, so what the heck. There we go. Thanks for asking that, Nicole.
Mike Picardi, followed by John Peterson. Again, last call for comment, public comments.
Good evening, Council, Mayor, staff, and citizens. I would like to add something to what Jeff Horton said. There is a Vietnam Memorial Wall Committee, and the dates have been set. It's June 22nd through the 26th of 2017. So please mark your calendars. That's when the wall will be here. A couple of events coming up. There are 33 events between today and the next council meeting listed on the DHS daily calendar. I'd like to highlight a couple of them. This Thursday, the 19th, here at the Calmay, is the Jazz Cafe beginning at 6 p.m. This is a monthly platform for members of the community, anyone, it's open to anyone and everyone, to express themselves through forms of performance talents that they may possess. The next one I want to bring up is the Meet Your Local Author series, which is starting back up after the holidays. This is going to be on February 2nd, here again in the Calmay at 6 o'clock. We will be presenting celebrated author, educator, film producer, and motivational speaker Joanna Stark. She will be talking about her latest book, A Woman of Vision, the true story of a blind woman's life and accomplishments, and the one last thing on her bucket list. Both of these events are sponsored by the Friends of the Desert Hot Springs Library. The last of the many events coming up is next week, actually a week and a half away, on the 26th of January, is the Historical Society Soup Supper, which is one of their fundraisers. The feature presentation will be by Saul Boydus. Rusted cans and broken pottery tell stories, revealing the history through artifacts collections. This should be very educational, interesting. I guess he's collects and catalogs our trash and what we do, and talks about how it reflects our society and what's going on. This will be at the Miracle Springs Resort and Spa beginning at 6 o'clock. Contact for further information is Dot Reed, and she can be reached at 760-835-4576. Again, thank you for your time, and thank you for all you do. Thank you.
Thank you. John Peterson.
Good evening, Mayor and council members. I'm John. I come as a local business owner. I'm a general contractor and real estate broker in the city. I don't know if this is the right place to ask my question. The question I have is regarding a property up on Mission Lakes and Palm Drive. There's a mid-century home up there. Right next door to it, there's a property that's been abandoned for several years. I've been in town for over 20 years working, and I know that it's been there longer than that. I had gone to the city and I had proposed if they would be willing to do a zoning change on that property. I believe at one point it was a sales office for Wardman Heights subdivision. I believe there was some city business that had taken place in that building at one point. It's just a little box. It looks bad. It's got an abandoned parking lot on it already. It's on the edge of the residential. Across the street is the rip, the wash, and the spillways and all that. And my main question is the city basically told me, the planning department said, maybe you should start at the council instead of wasting all the time to go through everything. What's the feasibility of it going to be able to change the zoning on it to be able to open a small construction business there? Very minimal signage, if any, and not at all. We would be willing to redo the whole building and take it from a big eyesore in town to make it blend in with the neighborhood, redo the whole place, the whole nine yards, to get permission from all the neighbors. We've been in town with different model homes throughout town from the 80s through all the way to today. And I don't, that's my question is it, if I go into the whole process of doing a variance on that one parcel, is it gonna go through? I don't wanna go through and spin my wheels and spend a lot of money to not have it go through. Like I said, we've been in business in town. My dad was here for 25, 30 years. I've been here for a lot longer than that. My business has been for 17 years. So that's my question. I don't know, and I know you guys can't answer those kind of things.
We can't talk back and forth, but I'd like you to suggest to you to leave your information with the city clerk and the city manager's office. We'll get in touch with you.
Great. And we'll really do appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Thanks for your time. And we look
John.
Forward.
John, come right over here.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I have nobody else in public comments. Would anybody like to speak? Must stand now. All right, public comment. Oh, sorry. Please come forth. When you're done, can you please fill out a blue sheet and hand it to the city clerk with your information? Just state your name, and when you state your name, your 3 minutes will begin.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Sylvia Aquino. You all know me by now. I have the problem with the neighbors in the back. They're still there. They're not my neighbors, sorry. It's a lot of bums living there. They're still there, and basically I just came because I think the last meeting that we had, you guys said we would cover this topic. They're still there, and I'm actually the neighbor of that parolee at large that was caught last week sometime. So thank you for doing that, because once again, that's trouble to my kids. I just want to say thank you to the police force for doing that, and hope to hear some good news today.
Sylvia, if you want to stay in the back there, I'll have someone from staff talk with you about where the ordinance is and all that.
Okay.
Mr. City Manager, okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else like to speak in public comment? Sylvia, please fill out a blue sheet, too, and give us a city clerk. Thank you. All right, with that, we'll move on to city manager's report.
This is the first meeting for our interim community development director, Charles Rangel. I'd like to introduce him to the community as well to the council. If you haven't met him yet, we'll all be sitting down with him the next couple of weeks. He'll be joining us on our weekly meetings, so you can ask questions and interact a little further. We're very excited to have him here. He comes with a plethora of experience, years in planning in the building industry, and we're fortunate that he has joined us and filled a very large hole.
Well, good evening, Mayor and council members, and to the community. Been here 3 weeks. It's been great. I'm glad to bring all of my experience and resources and energy here. And I'll tell you, Coachella Valley is, I've worked out here before. I've been a consultant to many cities. I've been staff to many cities in the Inland Empire and Orange County. And thank you for welcoming me. And thank you, Chuck, for that.
Well, welcome, and welcome to the family. Thanks. We're one big family. We don't always get along, but we're a good family. Anything else from the city manager's office? Any staff members?
The fire department will be taking place, or will be participating in two career events at the local Bubbling Wells on Wednesday or Thursday, and Painted Hills February 23rd. And we'll have an engine company out there with the children and giving them tips on fire department career.
Great.
Question for the city manager?
Yes.
So what's the answer to Sylvia's question? I'm dying to hear. I know she's getting the answer back there, but I'd like to hear it.
We've had code enforcement issue citations at that location. As you know, the police department also did a sweep at that location. We have open cases currently.
Great. So it's not a case of nothing being done?
No, we're in process right now of actually several different things, but as you know, it's a process, so.
Yeah, I know. Sometimes the public gets impatient and don't realize how long it takes that just steps we have to follow, so, but those steps are underway, so that's good.
Yes, sir. Thank you for asking. I should have given that information prior.
Any other staff members? We've got a lot going on in the city. You're going to see a lot of progress coming very, very soon in a lot of areas. So if you have questions about items, please feel free to give them to the city council. Our police chief gave an update on Operation Sandstorm. Did I get that right? Earlier today at the 5:30 presentation period, Sandstorm. Thank you. So if a lot of you remember Operation Falling Sun many years ago, the police department has followed up many times since then, and it just, I believe the number was around 29 individuals were taken into custody today on parole checks. So it was a good day for our police department to go out and make sure everybody was in compliance. With that said, we'll move on to council member comments. Council members can put their names in the queue. That would help. And Mr. Betts, you're up first.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thanks for those questions that came at public comment. I particularly like to get those type of questions, stuff, you know, step up and ask, and way to get it. A lot of people will hear the answer and move on. It's been busy. This is the first time we're back since New Year, I guess, so Happy New Year, everybody. While we were away, I attended the Palm Springs Airport Commission on December 21st, and I'll be down there again tomorrow at 8 a.m., I volunteered to spend a shift at the visitor kiosk at the airport. That's where you greet visitors, answer their questions, tell them about the community. And I'm thinking if they ask where's a great place to get a hotel room or spend the night, we'll know where to direct them. So I think they are looking for volunteers. And if anybody from Desert Hot Springs would like to go down there, it's something you'd volunteer for on a regular basis. But we'll see how it goes. I think it's going to be interesting. Met with Michael Bush, who's our consultant helping us with long-range financial planning, and spent some time studying that. Attended the Two Bunch Palms. They had a, an orientation event to show the improvements that have been made down there, and it's quite an iconic property. I was a little worried that when they said they had made changes to the grotto, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, what did they do? And they made it better. It's really nice. So if you get a chance to go down there and have a look, it's they took out a lot of tamarisk trees and brought in cranes. I think they said they had to bring them in from LA to get those things out of there. And then they replaced them with palm trees, big palm trees. And this was top shelf work they did when they were done. You can't tell that there'd been any work done. I mean, it's just, so anyhow, there's some new good owners down there. Went to the Senior Center Christmas party. That was nice. Attended Southern California Association of Governments on January 25th. Nothing of significance, too much in that meeting until Joe, who was also there, gets onto his ideas or tells us what he did, and then it'll be significant, right? It's always good to wait till after he speaks, and then I can copy my notes from him, but anyhow, I jumped in first this time. Attended the Airport Land Use Commission. We did have a couple projects in the Coachella Valley. One was approval of a development down on the by the Jackson Street overpass. The Airport Land Use Commission just makes a recommendation as whether or not it's compatible with any airports that are in the region. And so that project was a little bit of work, but it did manage to get it through. Met with the Sunline General Manager to cover some issues there. I've moved into the position of chair since I was vice chair, but the chair wasn't able to serve anymore, so I've moved into that spot. I want to thank the organizers of the Martin Luther King walk and ceremony. It was a nice job. I needed the exercise, especially after the holidays. That was almost a mile-long walk. It was good. And this weekend, I think, if the weather holds up, but I'm not sure it is, we're supposed to be taking a trip with some city youth up to Joshua Tree to educate them about the National Monument. We may push that one back to next weekend because I understand this weekend we have a lot of rain coming. So that was probably the call I got on my phone just a minute ago, is letting us know that it's probably better to move that date back. Other than that, Mr. Mayor, we had a long meeting, and I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember McKee.
I went to a lot of meetings. I'll talk about SCAG a little bit just because Russ brought it up. The major thing we're doing in SCAG is starting to reintroduce the RENA project, which is the methodology by which you tell people in various communities how much low-income housing they should be building. This is something that both Russ and I have been working on really hard to try and make sure that people understand that there are communities that already have a lot of low-income housing, and the standard should be different for us. Something more interesting than that is we talked a great deal about the state's goals for 2030 and 2050. 2050 is something I'm not going to have to worry about, so I won't talk too much about that. But 2030 is a goal to reduce greenhouse gases by 40% in the state. And in the past few years, we've gone from 14 tons a person to 11 tons a person. The problem I have with this is I think it doesn't deal with greenhouse gases that are made elsewhere. For example, if you have a high mileage hybrid and you go buy an electric vehicle because it gets 50 miles to the gallon more, you're actually generating more greenhouse gases by doing that than you're going to save by getting that electric vehicle because of the greenhouse gases that are expended to build the vehicle. And one of the problems I have with the state is it doesn't look at that. It only looks at what's generated in our state. And I think the standard has to be modified to take into account that, because we're just really, number one, fooling ourselves. And number two, I think the 2050 goal is a bit out of line with reality. As I said, before they started with greenhouse gases, they were 14 tons per person. The 2050 goal is 2 tons a person. That's half of what most people right now generate just on transportation, not counting anything else. So I think as we move toward these goals, we've got to start talking about how we're going to get there and how it's going to affect other portions of the country and the world and everything else. I support, without any reservation, trying to reduce greenhouse gases. But I think that we can't just throw things against the wall bluntly and have no idea how you're going to get there and avoid dealing with the unintended consequences that happen because of what California is doing to other states, that the process needs to be reviewed as far as I'm concerned. And I hope Mr. Cromwell, who's sitting there, at least nods a little bit. He's much more into this than I am. So I think that this is something that everyone should start thinking about, reading about, and seeing what's happening, because I think it's a good goal, but is it attainable, and is it realistic not to look in terms of overall greenhouse gases? Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Zavala.
Happy New Year. I attended a few Rotary meetings, so I attended the Christmas Rotary dinner, and then we had our first Rotary meeting of the year earlier this month, and I also attended a scholarship mixer and a neighborhood breakfast. I attended the Coachella Valley Mountains Conservancy meeting, attended Benoit's funeral along with the rest of the council and paid our respects. Attended the MLK Peace and Unity Walk, and also had a meeting with Michael Bush. Also attended the Two Bench Palms Christmas celebration / tour of the new improvements of the facility. And then the mayor and I had a meeting with some of the staff members, a one-on-one meeting with the Coachella Valley Mountains Conservancy. And then this weekend I'll be volunteering for the Career Builder Challenge to raise scholarship funds for Rotary. So I'll be there, come by and buy some things from our booth so we can raise money.
Mayor Pro Tem Parks.
Yes, I'll be right alongside you, Annie Ellie at the Career Builders, as long as they can find me a place to sit and do whatever I have to do. The Rotary always participates in the Career Builder Challenge, and by doing so, they get reimbursed, and it goes into taking care of and sending kids to training, career training for them. So it's a good thing. You know, this since December 5th, I haven't had a meeting. All of the ones that I normally attend were canceled due to the holidays. So I did go to everything that all the other council members went to. The funeral, which was very, very well organized.
I couldn't imagine with 1,000 people how they were able to move through a communion as fast as they did. 10 minutes and it was over. It was fantastic. And the two bunch palms, although it was cold and rainy outside, I didn't stay outside. I came inside and I told the bartender, I said, you know, I'm supposed to be out there with everybody, so you can serve me in here just like you're serving them out there. So he did. He brought my hors d'oeuvres and everything, so I didn't have to sit out in the wet like everybody else. So my daughter had major back surgery, so a lot of the time that I was off was spent going back and forth to Orange County until she got out of the hospital on December 10th, and then it was a recovery period after that. So other than that, Happy New Year. Let's have a good year, and I'm looking forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you, and I'll wrap up with our comments here as quick as I can. I also attended the Two Bunch Palms, and I know it's already been talked about, but I had to reiterate what they put in over $2 million in renovation, and they're planned over time a $10 million renovation. They're actually going straight into another phase of renovation here real soon. This company that has bought Two Bunch Palms is A1, Class 1, and they're doing a fantastic job in making our community and our premier resort in our community look just fantastic. If you do spend time at Two Bunch Palms, you'll see what they did with the grotto and what the new pools that they provided, and it's just top of the line, something you won't see anywhere else. The Erica meeting, which is our radio system, was canceled, so did not attend that. The Convention and Visitors Bureau did have a meeting in December. They have another one coming up this Friday. Nothing pertained to Desert Hot Springs directly. I was asked to meet with Senator Stone at his office in Indio and his staff on a possible business moving to Desert Hot Springs, and I did meet with them and talk with them about that. The Veterans Committee is doing a fantastic job. Jeff Horton has been doing a fantastic job here in our community handling the Veterans Committee. He's been putting on the Veterans Day and the Memorial Day. He calls me the other day and says, Scott, I got some bad news. And I said, oh, he's going to quit as chairman. My brother's getting married on Veterans Day next year, so I can't plan it. I went, how far out is that? So he's a great guy. If you get a chance to go down to VFW and support them, they do dinner. I think breakfast on Sundays, and they do all kinds of meals, but do support them. With him and another group of individuals that have participated from the CCAC to just the community, they've supported an application that went off to the moving wall, and the moving wall approved it, and it's coming to Desert Hot Springs June 22nd. There's a lot of work that has to be done. You have to follow guidelines. You have to build platforms. You have to have a safe place. You have to get hotel rooms. There's about $10,000 in costs that's going to come. If you get a chance and you can donate, we would appreciate it. It'll go through the city's nonprofit. It'll be funneled back out to the Moving Wall organization, and you can see more details. If you haven't been on DHSDaily.com, this is your local online calendar for the community. It's no taxpayers' money are being used to put this on. This is all donations. It is no cost to you. You can put your event on there. It's approved by the administrator. It goes on there. As Mike Bacardi said, there's over 33 events from today till the next council meeting. That's how much is going on in Desert Hot Springs. So don't tell me there's nothing going on in Desert Hot Springs. To the MLK committee, congratulations on another successful event. Thank you for what you're doing, and we're here to support you on the next one. And then lastly, the revenue committee met, and some of the things that the revenue committee, if you don't know what the revenue committee is, it's an ad hoc committee of the city council, which is three independent individuals in the community that are appointed with two members of the city council as an ad hoc committee to look at issues facing either the budget or other issues. The revenue committee was put together to look at, start the process on the next budget cycle to see where we could save money or talk about other issues. One of the suggestions was to talk with our financial planners and talk about their perspectives on the future. So they did that with us. We put together a timeline to talk about the upcoming tax measures in 2020 and what that's going to do for Desert Hot Springs when they sunset. And so the city council will be getting the revenue committee asked staff and our consultant to put together a presentation to come forth very soon on recommendations on for the city council to look at for the future of Desert Hot Springs and its financial health.
Did I miss anything, Mr. McKee?
No.
Mr. City Manager? All right. With that said, I have nothing else to talk about, and we will move on to public hearings. Item number 10 in your agenda packet. This is the ordinance adopting the 2016 California Fire Code with amendments. And we have our deputy fire marshal here.
And the fire marshal.
Sorry, we have both of you here. If you'd like to introduce yourself, gentlemen, and it's all yours.
Just real quick, sir, before you start forward, I'd just like to really thank these gentlemen. They've made several trips out here, obviously, to prepare the council as to this item, and they are here tonight again. And they have done so very graciously, and I greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Honorable Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, council members, thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm James Frater, Riverside County Fire Department Fire Marshal. The item before you tonight is the first reading of the 2016 California Fire Code adoption with proposed amendments. One of the first things that Chief Hawkins asked me to work on when I started working at the Riverside County Fire Department almost 4 years ago was the uniformity and the consistency associated with our interpretations and application and regulations associated with the fire code. As part of that, back in 2013, we started a process to work on getting that uniformity in terms of our amendment packages, both at the Riverside County, at unincorporated county, and all of our partner cities. We made significant headway in 2013, and we've continued down that journey here in 2016, and that's, as a result, is the package before you. The package before you is essentially identical to the Riverside County amendment package. We did send that package to industry associations back in October. The BIA, Building Industry Association, the Desert Valley Builders Association, the National Association of Industry, National American, what was that, NAIOP? North American Industrial and Office Properties, sorry. And the BOMA, Building Owners and Managers Association. To date, we have received a letter of support from Desert Valley Builders Association. And to date, we have not received any negative comments from any of the other industry associations. With that, I'd like to introduce Kevin Reinertsen, a deputy fire marshal with us, who will give us a general overview of the amendment package.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, council members. Happy New Year, staff. this package can be looked at, broken into four different sections, or four segments, one being administrative provisions. Those are the administrative provisions that set us up to issue permits, enforcement, do the plan reviews. They also, those administrative provisions also cover the very high fire hazard severity zones, if there are any. I think we have one little area here. So it gives us enforcement capabilities there. The other is operations. Several of our amendments deal with operations for our fire department to conduct, well, example, fire apparatus access roads, getting us to the property, getting our engines within X feet of the property. So we have some amendments in here that address that. However, the road standards that are in here, in most cases, with the exception of parking lots, your city standard covers those roads adequately and beyond what we even require. The other requirements could be lumped into the actual building standards, where we actually make modifications to the code to affect how the building's being constructed. We have very few amendments. Some of the more significant ones are the fire sprinklers. In the past, the state did not adopt fire sprinklers for residential lock for one and two family dwellings. However, the state does now, so that's a statewide minimum. We make no amendments to that provision there. We stick with the state minimums. And we do affect commercial buildings compared to what the model codes do. But this is, like James had said, consistent with the other partner cities and Riverside County. Our modification triggers at 3,600 square feet. Some of the other partner cities are a little bit lower, all the way down to 2,000 square feet. Some are a little higher. So we're moving those forward. We've brought in several modifications for gated communities as well as gated commercial properties for operations again, so that when they roll up, they're not having to park on the street and get out, unlock the gate, they're able to go to it. We do have exemptions in there that exempt one and two family dwellings, and some other modifications that we've made deal with your very wide, your large warehouse occupancies in requiring the location of certain command centers, the actual requirement for a command center, very similar to a high-rise building, but these are just flat, but they're very large, and this gives our firefighters the opportunity to get in those command centers, locate where the fire is, and it triggers at 300,000 square feet, so we're the very large buildings. And some other modifications were made regarding fire flows and hydrants, requiring a hydrant at an intersection and then triggering the distance from there. And that's, in a nutshell, the package, kind of a 30,000 foot overview of it. And I'm here for any detailed questions.
Great. I'm going to take public comments and I'll come back to the council. Anybody like to speak on this item? Please come forth. You'll need to come forth, state your name, and then make your comment. Remember, you'll have up to 3 minutes. The 3 minutes are on the screens behind us.
My name is Catherine Schoenfeld. I thank you for letting me ask this question. I'm a retired registered nurse of 42 years. When I came out here, the one thing that struck me the most was the wind systems through the San Gorgonio Pass. And I always wondered if someone threw a cigarette out of a car window and it caught fire on a very windy day in this area, do we have access to enough water, et cetera, for our fire department to safely handle something that could be potentially a prairie fire?
Thank you for the question. We'll see if we can get it answered for you. Any other public comments? Last call. All right, we'll move on to council member comments. Mr. McKee.
First of all, I want to thank you for coming in and meeting with us individually, but there are a couple of questions I'd like to ask. First of all, is there a national fire code?
Yes, there is. It's the international fire code. Mm-hmm. It is actually what the state of California adopts by reference to create the California fire code. So beginning January 1, 2017, well, 24 months ago, the state started that process in adopting the 2015 edition. And January 1, 2017, what's called the 2016 California Fire Code became effective statewide. What we're doing is moving forward our adoption and amendments to that code.
What are there differences between the National Fire Code and what we've passed in California?
Yes.
Why?
The International Fire Code is a base minimum code. So if you think about the United States, actually, you could think about it looking internationally because that code's actually adopted in other parts of the world, too. It's just a bare minimum code. Now, California, because of its geography, topography, our economics up and down, there's things that change. The International Fire Code and International Building Code themselves, in some cases, are a little lax in areas. So the state of California has upped those provisions a little bit in areas. Structurally, I'm not a structural engineer, but you know the seismic issues we have here in California. A lot of the changes that are made here in California to the code are reactionary to events that happen, whether it be fire events, earthquake, flooding, but we don't have a lot of that.
I'm in a quandary, to be honest, because we're also in a position that what we deal with as governmental people is the housing crisis. Mm-hmm. And what effect various government regulations have on everything from refurbishing stuff to building new stuff. And I know you guys aren't the major cost in that because there are some other things going on. But I'm concerned that we're significantly different than a lot of other states are. And the reason I'm concerned is specifically in a few areas, so we'll talk about that. We already voted to modify this, if I'm not mistaken, a few months ago, to modify the code so that certain things didn't exist in our portion of the code, specifically revolving around some refurbishing of old structures, things like that, because we were concerned that if let's say someone wanted to come in and refurbish a 12-room spa, that the cost of putting a sprinkler system in would make it economically infeasible. And so from our standpoint, what you would end up with in a lot of cases is a substandard studio apartment building that had actually more problems and more calls from the fire department on health issues in a lot of cases. There are some unintended consequences as far as I'm concerned with this, and we discussed this earlier. I was more concerned with the discussions in manufactured homes. According to this, if I were to have an old manufactured home in one of the communities in Desert Hot Springs, and I wanted to remodel it, would I have to put a sprinkler system in?
No. The regulations package that we're requesting be moved forward and adopted are not retroactive. They only apply to new. The state of California, the state fire code or the state residential code or building code have very little retroactive requirements in it. So since that's an existing, whether it's an existing dwelling or an existing apartment complex, existing hotel, or existing manufactured home, if they're remodeling it, our ordinance does not retroactively apply.
What about a spa? A hotel.
Oh, not retroactive. Sorry. They're not retroactive. So if you have that existing hotel and they're doing a retro.
The reason I brought this up is I think we've had some conflict in the last few months with someone wanting to require a sprinkler head in a entrance area in one of the spas that does exist. So yeah. I think there's some confusion there.
We could circle back to that and
I just want to make sure you understand that. That was resolved. Okay. On the positive front, I totally support the hydrant station, the thing that you've talked about here. I don't know if anybody here has watched what happens if there's a fire north of Mission Lakes Boulevard. But they have to roll out hundreds of feet of hose because there are hydrants at the base of the hill, and there's nothing for blocks, really, because there are no cross streets. So I think that's something that we should look at in the northern part of the city, because if something bad really does happen, that is a huge amount of work that you have to do to get water to the fire that's going on. I just wanted to make sure that you understand that our perspective is we want people to refurbish structures, hotels, everything in this city. And if we make it economically infeasible, it's going to be a real big problem for us, because unlike Indian Wells or Rancho Mirage, a spa or hotel in Desert Hot Springs can't charge $250 a night, generally, with the exception of Two Bunch and some of the higher end ones. But the smaller ones have a great deal of time surviving now. And if we keep adding additional requirements onto what they have to do, it makes them more and more economically infeasible. And it actually puts us in a position that those properties go downhill and are used for other purposes that we really don't want them to be used for in the future. So thank you.
Okay, I know it's above your pay grade, but is there enough water resources here to put out a large fire as asked by the public?
I'm actually going to defer that to Chief Brooks.
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, I've already asked the chief. He will speak with that lady before she leaves.
Great. Thank you. Next, Councilmember Betts.
We don't get the answer.
Chief, go ahead and answer that if you would.
Yeah, I can go ahead and share on that.
Not waiting to hear what it is. Yeah.
When we're talking about vegetation fires, wildland fires, a lot of the water that is provided essentially comes on the engines, and then we have water dropping aircraft that will pull water out of the nearest lake, pond, particularly our helicopters, and then the air tankers will go back to the closest air base, which would be Hammett Ryan,
and reload. They don't actually drop water, they drop retardant. And then the engines refill, they will go to a water tender, which refills at the nearest hydrant. And I've fought fire in some of the most isolated places in California that you could imagine. And typically, water is not an issue. And out here in the desert, we have plenty of sources of water. So,
thank you, Chief. Mr. Betts.
Thanks, Chief. I just wanted to thank you for the time you spent with us. There were some concerns, as Councilmember McKee explained, regarding the renovation of former boutique spa hotel properties. And I'm satisfied those are taken care of. And heck, if the Building Industry Association says it's not going to kill their industry, I guess we're okay. So that's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Ms. Zavala.
I just want to make a motion to approve.
There's a motion on the table. Is there a second?
Second.
Go ahead and push your button. Any more discussion? Mr. Betts, Ms. Zavala, you in the queue? All right, please vote. And that'll be our first reading.
Motion passes unanimously. This is an introduction and first reading of an ordinance amending Title 15, Buildings and Construction of the City of Desert Hot Springs Municipal Code to repeal and readopt Chapter 15.24 California Fire Code with selected appendices and amendments, and to repeal Chapter 15.56 NFPA 101 Life Safety Code. The ordinance shall return on February 7th for second reading and adoption.
Thank you, gentlemen. Item number 11 is the annexation number 8 to the City of Desert Hot Springs Community Facilities District number 2010-1 services, and this is the Candescent project, which is on Two Bunch Palms Trail. I took over a $250 donation from this company. I'll be recusing myself from this item. Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, this is the annexation number 8 to the City of Desert Hot Springs Community Facilities District number 2010-1 Services Candescent. The Administrative Services Director, Joe Tanner, will be providing the staff report, and I will open the public hearing and hear the staff report.
Thank you, City Council. Staff is respectfully asking for a continuance of this item. We have not received the ballot yet. We have been told that is in the mail.
That's it.
That's it.
Okay. Is there any testimony? Is Candescent here?
A point of clarification, Madam Mayor Pro Tem. Candescent is leasing the property. The actual owner is a separate company, and
are they here?
They are. They're not here tonight.
Okay, it's my understanding that they want to be continued because they didn't get the paperwork for the ballot.
We're asking for that continuance. Yes.
Okay, so I will not close the public hearing. I will leave it open and entertain a motion to continue.
Motion to continue.
To when? To a date specific?
Within 30 days.
February 7th? Okay. We have a second? Please vote.
Motion passes unanimously.
You act like you've done that before.
I guess it just comes back.
I do have to say, when Scott comes back, I can talk and fill line in here. I never got to run a meeting during my whole year, and the first meeting that Yvonne's here, she gets to run the meeting. So I'm feeling very bad.
Oh dear, I'm so sorry, Joe.
Item number 12 is the conditional use permit application CUP 23.16 and development agreement DA 15-16 for the construction of a 57,907 square foot medical marijuana cultivation facility located on the southwest corner of Two Bunch Palms Trail and Cabot Road in the light industrial zone, APN 665-030-058. The applicant is Bunch Palms Trail LLC, Medi Farachi. And that's going to be our interim community development director, Charles Rangel.
Actually, it's going to be Scott who's going to be making the staff presentation.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, and council members. Good evening. Before I start into a staff report, I have noticed a few clerical errors on the staff report and also in the findings, so I want to address those. Page 125, the beginning of the staff report, under title, it says 57,907. The actual square footage is 62,820. It was also not, well, here, under page 128, under Planning Commission, it has the incorrect date. Instead of July 20th, they actually heard this on December 13th of 2016. And there's also, on page 135, there's a discrepancy between the beginning of the staff report and one of the findings under development agreement where it says 1.07 acres. The actual acreage is 2.14 acres. Staff has also recently gotten a revised site plan, which we have provided for you tonight. It does indicate areas for the semi-truck parking. There's two different areas that have been highlighted. I believe it's on the north and on the east. Two different, but it's on the site plan that's been provided. And they have also provided staff with a full-size copy for our records. I also want to go through, the staff report wasn't terribly clear on the square footage the way it was written. The total square footage is 62,820. Of that, 57,910 is for cultivation, with the remaining 4,800 plus for ancillary uses, office, restroom, hallway, storage, break room, et cetera. And there's an apartment upstairs. Staff also received a question about the 24-hour security and whether that included, you know, the employees sleeping in the apartment, which staff has been advised. The apartment will be for employee and owner use only. No security guards will be sleeping there. Armed security will be provided by an independent security company 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. The final security plan will be approved by the police chief with a regulatory permit, including security staffing. In addition, in approving the project under recommendation, there's a series of findings. Staff has noticed a couple clerical errors in those findings that are in the staff report and has also beefed up some of the findings to make a better case and just have stronger findings. Those findings have been provided to each of the council members prior to the meeting. So you should have in front of you the revised site plan and also the revised findings for the recommendation. With that, I also, staff would also like to note that this project was originally approved December 15th, 2015 under a different CUP. Because of some legal issues with the prior owner, staff ended up revoking that CUP and recommended the new client just resubmit the project. There are no revisions except for that dotted area on the site plan that shows the semi-truck parking. But in doing so, back in December of 2015, the council adopted the initial study mitigated negative declaration prepared for the project, and they have not, all the mitigation measures will remain applicable to the project, and no revisions to the adopted mitigation measures are proposed. With that, just a brief reminder, it's at the southwest, the site is at the southwest corner of Cabot Road and Two Bunch Palms. The project site is surrounded by light industrial zoning and some existing sites, you know, that use the light industrial, have light industrial uses. As you can see, surrounded by light industrial zoning and uses. This is the original site plan. The site plan in front of you does have a revision indicating the truck parking. The building height, I believe, varies from 30 feet to 37 feet. Staff can speak more to the architecture and landscaping, but the architecture did originally receive good positive comments. The landscaping is a mix of drought-tolerant species, including bougainvillea, palm, and a few others that are mentioned in the staff report. Here's the color palette for the exterior design and elements. Here's the landscape plan, parking, the based on the square footage and the uses. The parking requirement would be 41 parking stalls, two of which have to be handicapped. The proposal is includes spaces for 42. So they meet the parking requirement. They meet all the setback height requirements, the general plan policies. And here again, it's just a reminder about the environmental that was approved with the original project. And then on December 13th, Planning Commission conducted a public hearing of the proposed request. Following receipt of the staff report and public comment, the commission recommended approval of the conditional use permit and development agreement, subject to conditions of approval. No significant concerns or comments were raised by the commissioners prior to their action. One other thing on the staff report, under on the first page, it's actually page 125, under recommendation number 9. This, if you skim over, it's actually the first reading. This is not the second reading of this proposal. With that, staff's available if you have any questions. The applicant and their consulting, environmental planning, architectural representative is here as well.
Before we get to the applicant, do we have any questions for staff from the council? Yes. Mr. Betts.
Thank you. What's the amount of the art and public places contribution, and will it be a direct contribution to the city, or will they be placing art themselves on the project site?
They have not, to my knowledge, they haven't proposed any art on the site, so they would be subject to that condition, and I believe it's a percentage of the value of the project.
Okay, so they're making the contribution or the payment.
That's one of the conditions of approval, yes.
That's in there?
Yeah.
Good. And now after, provided that we approve this, it goes on to plan check?
We'll have a second reading, and then yes, they can submit for plan check.
Okay, and so on a project like this, total, what do you call them, person hours now? To approve plans and something like that. The guys actually got to sit down, look at them, review them. How many hours would you say that is?
Well, that
24, 48?
As far as the building
80?
Department?
We send them out for plan check,
California
correct?
Code check.
All right, so guys actually sitting there looking at these, working on them. Has he got 40 hours into this, 40 solid hours into plans like this, 80 hours?
That I'm not sure I can answer, but I mean, they have to review all the plumbing, the electrical, the structural. It would be fairly extensive. I mean, their turnaround is 4 to 6 weeks
okay.
for them to get it back to us.
Okay. What I'm getting at is I think we got a problem with the turnaround because, one, they're running longer, I think, than 4 to 6 weeks, and that's not good. These gentlemen are here, want us to invest a significant amount of money in our city, and I'm asking the city manager if you would take a look at that, please. If there's 40 hours worth of work to approve these plans, and let's just double that and say it's 80 hours, maybe the engineers in the room can tell us, but let's just say a guy works on it solid for 2 weeks. Give him a few days for mailing. I want it back in 3 weeks. We need to pressure these guys. They're taking too long. There's too many projects being held up too long down at the plan check. So if we could just monitor that, I'd be happy on this project. And let the applicant know that if you run into any problems along those lines, you're free to call any council member. We can't bend any rules for you. We can't do anything, but if you send plans down there and you're not hearing anything back and you think you should, and you know, I'm sure the staff will be responsive, but if you're not, that's what we're here for. So I'll extend that to you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. That's all I've got.
Ms. Zavala?
On page 283, and this is the development agreement, section 3.5.1, under term extension. This is triple I, I guess you would call it, the subsection. I just wanted to make note of the use of the double negative again. So in essence, what that's saying is that they are not in default for not curing whatever, you know, fault we've deemed that they're, you know, committing, you know, with their development. So I just want to make sure we remove one of the knots.
I will. Thank you. That was my fault.
And then just a few points that I wanted to share with the public that I did ask in my meeting with the city manager earlier this week. So just so that people are aware, the greenhouses, there are four greenhouses that are part of this project, and just so that everybody knows, they are all permanent structures, so they're all indoor and indoors and covered. And then my other question was in regards to the request to defer the site improvements and the power pole. So those are being deferred until Edison decides where they want to have the pole constructed, so that the developer doesn't have to go and do the work twice in case they decide they want the power pole, somewhere else. So those are just things that I wanted to bring up to the public.
Thank you. Councilmember McKee.
Hopefully this will be fast. I'm really concerned about the four-week thing with the with the turnaround on California code check. We've been told in the past that it was 2 weeks, and that's the information we've been telling various people that come in to talk to us, and we're trying to tell them we're moving quickly, but making sure that everything is as it should be. I think if it's taking twice as long, there's something wrong.
One of the first things that I brought up to Charles when he started was that we are going to look for other options for our plan checks outside of California Code Check. Now, but there's one thing that everybody needs to understand. When we send them out, the initial review is probably about 2 weeks long, and they have to comply to all the conditions. Then we have to send it back one more time for another review. But we do believe that the process has been taking too long, and so I've asked Charles to find a few more locations, and then we'll test the waters with them and get that the process expedited.
Since we discussed this before you got here, I would like to add an addendum to that, though. One of the things we've had trouble with is, as it is sent back to California Code Check, it would come back with additional requirements that were new. And our feeling is they get one bite at the apple. If they send it to a different guy to check it the second time and they made a mistake, we're almost of the opinion that if somebody has to change something, they should pay for it because they've made the mistake at that point. And we shouldn't burden people with, okay, we found something else. Well, you should have found that the first time. You're supposed to be a professional organization. So thank you.
Yes, sir, and that's one of the other items that we discussed as well with Charles. You know, our concern was is that one person will put eyes on it initially, then when it goes back, another person's putting eyes on it. And we want to keep some consistency here, so we were getting the exact answer the first time around instead of having to do two or three iterations.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Zavala is back in the queue. She has another question.
My last question was in regards to the loading zone. Is that also going to be designated as the delivery parking?
Maybe we'll get the applicant to speak to that, but that's my understanding.
I'll bring the applicant up in a minute. We'll ask that question.
Okay.
Mr. Betts, you have another question for staff?
Yeah. What Edison poles need to move? This is on Two Bunch Palms. This isn't the problem with the large poles on Little Morongo. Correct? There's large poles on Two Bunch? Okay, so this project has site improvements. What are those site improvements that are being deferred? Landscaping, sidewalks, curbs, gutters, what? Nothing?
Yeah.
I thought I heard you say we were going to defer. Was that you brought that up?
Yeah, I did read on there that the developer requested that they defer the, it says phasing and defer of perimeter site improvements. And then it talked about the power pole and, you know, and then it says defer until such time it's needed.
Let me open the public hearing. I'll get the applicant up here and maybe we can get that directly answered
staff
for you.
Staff doesn't have that answer?
Well, let me ask staff.
Staff's understanding is that they're going to do this in one phase, and I believe that may have been a leftover from the previous staff report from a year ago. Okay. I think not the applicant this. Can speak more to that.
Okay, so then in that case, for this, so that was left over from the last one. So yeah. In this case, we are not going to see a deferment of the site improvements, which include, according to what I read, asphalt and concrete pavement, curbs and gutters, sidewalks, storm drains, catch basin, landscape, and irrigation. So that's not being deferred.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'm going to open the public hearing so we get the applicant up here since we're having a three-way conversation here. So I'm going to open the public hearing at this time. Applicants may come forth, and we're going to ask you a few questions. You already got a couple in the queue there, Paul. Please introduce yourself.
Mayor, members of the council, my name is Paul DiPilatis. I'm the planning director for MSA Consulting, and staff mentioned the project architect and the applicant are here as well tonight. I guess just briefly, so as staff mentioned, this project was approved about a year ago, and through the unfortunate actions of one of the consultants on the project, the applicant's been kind of penalized by some lost time and having to redo things again. So we've basically followed the path that staff recommended to us of basically reprocessing everything to get back to the point we were a year ago. So we're looking for an approval tonight so we can get this project back up and running again. In answer to your questions about the deferral and the development agreement, yes, that's kind of a mistaken clause. There is no deferral on this one. All the perimeter streets and curb and things would be constructed as part of the project. I didn't quite follow your question about the deliveries. Could you restate that?
That's just a question that we normally ask all applicants. We just want to make sure that there's a designated delivery parking space so that, you know, people aren't parking out on the street and, you know, backing up traffic. So I noticed that you guys did include the loading zone that would be big enough to accommodate a semi. And I just wanted to know if that's where you're planning to have your deliveries.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
So I don't know if I answered all the questions, if there are more, or if there are any design-related ones. The architect is here as well.
Mr. Betts, you're in the queue.
Yeah, this is just one quick question. Now, this site, it's already been graded, correct?
Yes, grading was started, and then it had to stop with the issues that were had.
Okay, but what I noticed is that it's been well-watered and kept moist. In fact, some residents were asking why there was so much water, but I'm not going to ever complain about that. I just want to thank you for being very responsible, not letting dust blow from your construction site. It's a welcome change.
Yeah, we'd like to get that resolved and get that done so it's not an issue anymore.
Well, it's not an issue. Dust isn't blowing off your site. It's not an issue. I'd like to get that thing built. I'm looking forward to this getting done.
Do we have any more questions from the council for the applicant? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We'll be back in a minute. I will take public testimony at this time. Anybody in the public would like to speak to the city council on this item? Second call. Final call. We will now move to rebuttal, but there is none. And we will now close the public hearing. And this is the opportunity for the applicant to rebut, but there is nothing to rebut. And now I'll give it back to city council. Mr. Betts.
Make a motion to approve.
There's a motion to approve and a second. This is on a first reading. If you look at item number 9, their approval, it says second reading. This is a first reading. Please vote. I'm sorry. I didn't see you come in.
And I just want to make. I just wanted to make sure that staff deleted the use of the extra not, and that we're also deleting the deferral of the site improvements.
That was part of your motion, correct?
Yeah, I should have picked that up.
All right, please vote.
Motion passes unanimously. Approving a first reading of an ordinance approving the development agreement between the City of Desert Hot Springs and Bunch Palms Trail LLC.
Thank you, Mr. City Clerk. Congratulations. Thank you. Item number 13 is the appeal of the Planning Commission's action of denial. The first extension of time, tentative tract maps 35009 and 35448, located west of State Route 62 within the Rancho Royal specific plan encompassing most of Section 20, Range 14 East, Township 2 South, San Bernardino Baseline, and Meridian. Thank you. Interim Community Development Director Charles Ringel.
Mayor and City Council, this item came to the Planning Commission at their November 22nd special meeting. At that meeting, the Planning Commission took action to deny the extension of time. Staff had recommended approval of the extension. Subsequent to the action by the Planning Commission, the applicant has filed an appeal to the City Council. However, we received last week a letter from the applicant that due to a time conflict, they have requested that this be respectfully continued to the February 21st meeting.
Staff recommendation is to continue to February 21st. I have one person in the queue, Mr. Betts.
I was going to make a motion to continue this to February 21st.
Is there a second?
Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, if I may interrupt, it is a notice public hearing. We did go through notice and publication.
Sorry, I need to open the
public
hearing.
Just for the record, can we go ahead and open the public hearing, and then we'll go ahead and continue it to the 21st?
I will open the public hearing, and now I have a motion to continue to February 21st, 2017. I have a motion and a second. Please vote.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. Item number 14 is the ordinance to allow certain medical marijuana manufacturing facilities to request a minor modification to a conditional use permit to allow manufacturing of medical marijuana. Interim Community Development Director Charles Rangel.
Actually, the city attorney is actually going to make this presentation.
City attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. As you know, the chapter 17.180, as we all know, is kind of a living document. It's going to be forever changing, probably for as long as I'm here and the rest of my life. So the item that you have before you tonight came about because there's several cultivators who came and got permits and entitlements, et cetera, while cultivation was the only use that was actually allowed in the city. And of course now, or I should say medical marijuana use that was allowed in the city. But now, of course, we've changed that, and the City Council now has other kinds of uses like manufacturing, which is another word for extraction, distribution, and other kinds of uses in addition to just cultivation. And so what we found is that several cultivators have the conditional use permit, development agreement for the cultivation, but they're now coming to the city saying, listen, you know, my site's primarily for cultivation, but I'd like to have a small portion of it or whatever dedicated to the extraction side. In which case, right now, as it stands, they would have to go through the entire process all over again when they might not even be changing any part of their building. It's just kind of maybe some interior modifications to allow for the extraction. So the ordinance that you have before you tonight allows for an administrative approval of an existing cultivation facility that already has all of its permits to come into the city and work with our development department on an administrative approval for extraction. Excuse me, there's a whole bunch of findings that are actually in the ordinance that the director would have to find. For example, they couldn't do, the applicant couldn't do any kind of modifications to the outside structure. There's no parking, there's no, you know, circulation or parking issues. There's no environmental concerns, et cetera. In which case, if they're just kind of doing something on the interior of the building, that we would provide the director the okay to allow that kind of administrative approval. Of course, there's a caveat where if there's anything that the director feels that maybe is a little bit more than that, et cetera, that, of course, that application can then go to the Planning Commission if the director ever felt, hey, listen, this is a little bit out of my hands. We do need a little bit more direction. So that's the ordinance that you have before you tonight. I have a funny feeling there'll be more cleanup ordinances coming down the pike, but I think this is kind of a stopgap. Let me know if you have any questions.
I'll open the public hearing and I'll take public testimony. Would anybody like to speak on this item? Second call. Final call. I will close the public hearing and we'll take comments from the council. I have nobody jump. Oh, there we go. Ms. Zavala.
I would just like to make a motion to approve.
This will be the first reading of an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Desert Hot Springs amending section 17.108.060. There's a motion. Second. And there's a second. Any other discussion? Please vote. Mr. City Clerk.
Mr. Mayor, who would you recognize on the second? And why is my vote showing what it did? What do I do?
Mr. Betts is not off the dais. Can you please take a roll call vote?
Councilmember Zavala?
Aye.
Councilmember Parks?
Yeah.
Mayor Pro Tem Parks?
Yes.
Councilmember Betts?
Aye.
Mayor Mattis?
Aye.
Councilmember McKee?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously to introduce for first reading an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Desert Hot Springs amending section 17.180.060 medical marijuana manufacturing facilities of chapter 17.180 medical marijuana facilities operations and location of title 17 zoning of the City of Desert Hot Springs Municipal Code to allow certain medical marijuana manufacturing facilities to request a minor modification to a conditional use permit to allow manufacturing of medical marijuana.
Thank you very much. Move on to item number 15. Would the council like to take a quick break?
Yes.
Yeah, we're going to take, I'm sorry, Mr. Poon, we're going to take, now that we're switching over the administrative calendar, we're going to take a 5-minute break. All right, so everybody find your seats. We're going to get restarted. Is Mr. Betts back there? The administrative calendar is item number 15, the audit financial statements from fiscal year 2015-16. Mr. Tanner, do you want to do the introductions? This is a receive and file, so there's no vote on this. This is a presentation by our administrative services department.
Just real quick, thank you, Mr. Mayor and City Council. Before I introduce our auditor, I just wanted to say thank you to the finance staff who worked long and hard on this audit. We have a checklist that's about 4 pages long that we have to get through, and the work is pretty complicated and intensive. So a big thank you to my staff. And then with that being said, I'd like to introduce Mr. Ken Poon. Mr. Poon is with the Poon Group. He's been our auditor since 2014, and he's gonna run through his report pretty quickly, and I think he's got some very good things to say. And then also some words of caution as well as we move forward. So with that, Mr. Poon.
Good evening, Mayor. Mayor Pro Tem and member of the City Council, thank you very much for having me here tonight to present the audit of the City of Desert Hot Spring June 30, 2016 financial statement. So I'll keep it short, but these are the required communications that is required by the auditing standard. So what we are going to do today is actually going through the scope of work. There's a couple of things that we did for the city here, introducing to you the project team, the required communications by the auditing standard, which include the management responsibilities, also, and then all auditors' responsibilities, and then also walk you through the financial statement. How are we doing during this year? Couple big things. Retirement plan is a big ticket item the last couple of years, and also wanting to make some note on how you deal with the unfunded pension liabilities. Implementation of new GASB standard, there's not much, and then also talk about the audit results. So the scope of work actually include 4 different things. One is the audit of the basic financial statement, which is including in your packet. Also, with the city's basic financial statement, you also have a standalone health and wellness centers, the foundation financial statement. We also did the agreed upon procedures applied to the appropriation limit. And then also, last but not least, is we did some review on the TOT taxes that was being received by the city. So the project team is actually, besides myself, I have like a couple CPAs and a couple of my staff working on the job. And it's been really, really thorough. Instead of besides the 4 pages long, we do have a lot of inquiries talking with staff. They spend a lot of time because we did spend a whole lot of time evaluating the control environment and the internal control at the city. So as required by the auditing standard, auditing sections 380 is equivalent to the SAS 114 communication with those charged with governance. We are required to talk about the audit responsibility, any significant audit findings that we find in the audit. We only have 1 item that is a carryover from the previous year, and it has nothing to do with internal control. It's really relating to the financial condition of the cities, the accounting policies. There's a lot of different policies and procedures in place, and everything is reported in the notes to the financial statement. During the current year, there are 4 new GASB standard that's actually applied to the city. Actually, it needs to be implemented for the June 30, 2016 financial statement, but none of them actually have a significant impact to your financial statement. Not like last year, we have the implementation of GASB 68, the pension standard, so booking the unfunded liabilities to the face of the financial statement. This year is only disclosure. So there's no new measurement input to the financial statement, so there's no financial impact. Any significant difficulties encountered during the audit? We found none. Any disagreement with management in terms of application of accounting principle? We also have none. No consultation with other accountants, and then also we do not have any independence issue. Talking about the management responsibility, you are fully responsible for the financial statement. Management is responsible for to prepare the financial statement in accordance with accounting principle generally accepted in the United States of America. Financial statements are free of material misstatement, adopt sound accounting policy, establish and maintain proper internal control over financial reporting and compliance, providing evidence supporting to the amount and disclosure in the financial statement, and last but not least is to prevent and detect fraud. Our responsibility as an auditor is to perform the audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standard, and then also the government auditing standard, which is a much higher standard, talking about internal control. We communicate to you as as those charged with governance. We assess audit risk of internal control over financial reporting and compliance, and determine the fairness presentation of the financial statement, and last but not least is to render our audit opinion. So I'll give you a brief overview of the financial statement. In the report, there's like a couple sections. The big, our opinion is actually the first two items, report on the financial statement, and then also a report on internal control over financial reporting and compliance. The basic financial statement, including the government-wide financial statement, which I call it a consolidated financial statement for the city of Desert Hot Spring here. Fund financial statement is actually the day-to-day used by management. Is actually break it down by general fund, public safety fund, and the rest of the funds that is being used by the city, and then the notes to the basic financial statement. Also, GASB required, there are a couple of things that is included in the required supplementary information, which includes the budget to actual statement of revenue and expenditure of the general fund, and all the major special revenue funds, some of the pension schedules are in there, so those are required by GASB. And then other supplementary information is in the back of the financial statement. So as of June 30, 2016, let's go over the numbers. So you have a total asset of $94 million, total liabilities of $52 million, and then also you can see the deferred outflow resource and then deferred inflow resource. These two items are relating to the pension items, that some of the things that is being deferred for the future use. So, but the net position, it's about like $42 million, of which $29 million, close to $30 million is investment in capital asset. $10.7 million is restricted by third party, and then remaining $1.3 million as an unrestricted net position. The statement of activities, which is the income statement of the city. So as you can tell, the total expenses for the city is about like $18 million. Total program revenue, which include the charges for service that you can charge the user for a fee, the operating grant that is earned by the city, and the capital grant, total of close to $8 million. So the total net cost of service is about like $13 million. So the change in net position is about $3 million increase from prior year. So the next item is the general fund, which I also include the public safety fund, because this is a major operating fund of the cities. So the two funds added together, you have a total asset of $8.5 million, the liabilities of $1.8 million. Also, you do have the deferred inflow resource, which is the unavailable revenue, which will be received in the future, of $514,000. So the total fund balance of the city is about like of the general fund is about like $6.2 million, so which is a great improvement compared to last year. So also at the same time, take a look at the income statement for these two funds. Total revenue is about $17.8 million, net of expenditure of $11.6 million. So the net revenue over expenditure of $2 million. So you also have some other financing sources inflow to the fund of $188,000. So the net change in fund balance is $2.2 million. One of the things that I really want to show to you is the five-year trend. So you can see the significant improvement of the financial condition of the general fund operations. So the five-year trend, and I'm pretty solid the last 2 years. You do have about like $2.3 million of surplus in operations. That is actually helpful in improving the financial condition of the city. So one of the thing that I would like also like to point it out is the retirement plan, because this is this is not new, but last year was the first time in U.S. history booking the unfunded pension liability to the face of the financial statement. So based out of the last actuarial study, which is done as of June 30, 2015, you have a total aggregate net pension liabilities of $8.7 million. So that is the contribution of some of the deficit that you see in the governmental activities that was noted in the government-wide financial statement. During the current year, we do have four new GASB standard that's implemented during, for the fiscal year June 30, 2016. The only one that is really applicable to the city here is GASB 72 relating to fair value measurement. It's only talking about the disclosure, how these investment being valued and what are the market values on how you quoted your investment. So that is the only things changed to your financial statement during the current year. So the other results, we actually issue an unmodified opinions, which means that the financial statement are fairly presented in all material respect. Significant accounting policies have been consistently applied. Estimates are reasonable and the disclosure are properly reflected in the financial statements. Other results, we also did issue a emphasize of the matter. It is not a qualification, but emphasize to you that there are some uncertainty because as of June 30, 2016, the city's governmental activities had had an unrestricted net position of a deficit of $13.7 million. Out of the $13 million, this is a accumulated deficit coming from all the in the past year. But out of this $13.7 million, $8.8 million is actually coming from the net pension liabilities. So the management plan on how to address to recover these deficits are also described in the management discussion and analysis. But also, we also did point it out as one of our observation, as our finding, because this is a carryover item, because we understand that the city's public safety tax measure is going to be expire in the year of 2020. So we estimate the revenue shortfall will be about like $5 million. But also you do need to keep that in mind, the cost of service is actually increasing every year. A couple of the things, CalPERS unfunded liabilities, the annual required contribution rate is going up. Given the fact that the CalPERS already have the plans on reducing the discount rate from 7.65 to 7%. So that has some major impact to your annual required contribution. The fire prevention, the rescue, animal service, and medical emergency that's operated by the county is also going up too. Additional staffing to support economic growth. The legal and consulting service associated with the new market tax credit is still there. Also, the one last thing that I want to point it out is the operating costs for the for health and wellness center. On an average, every year we saw that there's close to $800,000 deficit every year in order to run the health and wellness center. So that is always a cost that the general fund needs to subsidize to. So we highly recommend the city work diligently on a fiscal plan to help balance the budget and build up a general fund reserve. It's very important, but it's crucial to the city because it's a great year. We see a lot of improvement in not only on the financial condition, but also on internal control too. So that's conclude my presentation. So I'm happy to answer more than answer any question that you may have.
Mr. Poon, I'm going to ask you to step aside for 1 second while I take public comments. Anybody like to speak to this item? Second call, final call. All right, you may step back. Council members, any questions? I have nobody in the queue. Would anybody like to speak? Mr. McKee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. First of all, and mostly because we've had an hour plus to speak with you today, and we thank you for your work. I just wanted to compliment the city and specifically the Administrative Services Department. They finished this 2 months earlier than last year, and I think that that's a huge accomplishment, and we appreciate that. This is good and bad. I mean, we've over the last few years, we've done a good job as far as building up the general fund, and we're not in a position as the first year where we're worried about paying the bills.
Correct.
Longer term, all government agencies are in a position that they're seeing expenses rise and funds coming in, revenue flat. And I think that's something we're going to have to work on for the next few years. Could you talk a little bit about what we talked about this afternoon as far as another methodology of dealing with the unfunded liability in CalPERS?
Sure, because we talk about the CalPERS plan and also the historical trend in the last 2 years with the investment portfolio is being really, really flat. There's another option is that using a 115 trust that is allowable under the government code to set aside additional money for as a stabilization purpose. So in case of anything that's happened to CalPERS, they did not actually have the investment earnings didn't come in as stated at 7%, you can use the 115 trust as a stabilization fund to fund these any required contribution. The downside is we cannot use the 115 trust asset to net against the net pension liability, but this is the only downside. But you have full control of your investment. You can have your investment board to decide what investment that you want to invest your set aside money. But this fund is also irrevocable. So that is one of the options that I saw is really, really helpful to address the issue dealing with pensions.
I would hope that we five can agree that we want to look into this really a lot over the next few months and put ourselves in a position, bluntly, that we make sure we just don't keep throwing good money after bad. Now, the negative to this, obviously, is if the CalPERS investment portfolio can do better than you, there's some... You can go both ways here.
You can both go both ways.
So I think we need to be cautious, but I think on the other hand, it sounds better to me to have it under our control than necessarily under CalPERS right now. I think that's about it. As far as I'm concerned, again, thank you very much. We appreciate your work.
Mr. Betts.
Thank you. I think at this point you got to compliment compliment the city council and the city staff, but it was the city council that made some really tough decisions over the course of a couple of years. I remember when you were here before and it wasn't such good news.
Mm-hmm.
And we're beyond that now, so that's good. I know Councilmember McKee said it's good and bad news, and I know he's looking towards what's out there in 2020 and some of the other issues, but generally I'm looking at this as really good news because it's showing discipline in our spending and that it's confirming the reporting that we're getting out of our city staff is correct. This is really the time of the year when staff's been telling us all along we're okay, but you just put your stamp of approval on it and confirmation that yes, what they're telling you has been good, and we are early, which is nice. So I think that indicates that there's nothing unusual, you're finding things are being run as they should be.
Yes.
So to me, it's a really good sign that, what was it, 60.2 million approximately And that includes the leaf, or is it
included leaf funds?
Okay, yeah. So that's a whole lot better than being coming up way short and having to make all the kinds of cuts that we did. The Health and Wellness Center is a concern with an $800,000 a year deficit. That's a problem we need to look at and see how we solve it. It's obviously not going to happen overnight, but the problem is clearly stated to us, which is another sign of progress around here, is that we're able to identify what the situation is, because if you don't know what it is, you can't address it. The pension issue, that's real complicated, but I'll join Councilmember McKee in saying that I'm open to looking at some possibilities there. I don't know how exactly we structure that, but. And then we got a few remaining options on revenue generation possibilities out there that I've been pushing quietly, and I'm gonna start making a little bit more noise on it, see if we can get those scheduled. Staff knows what I'm talking about, and you know, obviously they need to get a more detailed look at it, but I'm hoping those are moving along to see if something the council wants to do will pan out. You know, and the other good news is the spending's under control. I haven't seen any wild spending going on up here. You know, things are pretty tight where we didn't even buy a pack of gum because we didn't have the money for it. And now it's relaxed a little bit, but it still hasn't gone to the point where there's any type of irresponsible spending that I can see. I'll speak up if I see any, but so far everybody here is doing good. So anyhow, I want to thank you for your efforts, and thanks for time today.
You're welcome.
This is much better news.
Ms. Savala.
Thank you. I just wanted to take a moment to remind the public that's, you know, watching at home, that we have our auditor here warning us and giving us caution in regards to the $5 million shortfall that we're going to be experiencing in 2020 when the user utilities tax and the parcel tax sunsets. So we need to make sure that that's something that's addressed, and clearly it's not something that's just coming from council. We have our auditor here who is making sure that he lets us know that's something we need to be mindful of.
And I'll wrap everything up by saying thank you for your work. Staff, you've got some direction today from what the council feels we need to look at. Obviously, the pension is something that I think needs to have a real in-depth conversation on, so that we're all comfortable with that. And then reiterate what everybody else said, you know, taxes are important in the future, or the tax issue is going to be very important in the future to discuss, and all the other issues that you outlined. But thank you for your work.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, we're going to move on to item number 16, the professional services agreement with the Poon Group, Incorporated for professional audit services. Mr. Tanner?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I've asked the administrative services director if he would agree with me. We'd like to postpone this to a future meeting. We are very pleased, obviously, with the Poon Group's services they've provided in the past, but they have been here for 3 years, and we've had previous council direction that after 3 years we should be considering an RFP. And so I would like to be able to postpone this into a future meeting where I can come forward and make a recommendation for a RFP.
Do you have a motion?
So moved.
Do you have a date certain, or just table it for now?
We'll be back at the next meeting.
Okay. So February 7th, we'll be back with a recommendation. There's a motion and a second. Please vote. February 7th.
Okay.
Next item is the award of the contract for the Senior Center Operations. Mr. Tanner.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, City Council. I do have two corrections to the report, page 551 on the evaluation seat. The second rating experience with senior centers, it should have been a 12, not a 15, and the staff qualifications should have been an 8. And not a 10. So I do apologize for that confusion. But that being said, the recommendation still stands as it is to execute an agreement with Mizell Senior Center for a period of 3 years with options for year 4 and 5 and amount to not exceed $125,000. And when this RFP was issued, we did receive three responses from one from the current vendor, FSA, Family Services Association, Smooth Transitions, and also Mizell. Their responses were graded on the cost, the qualifications and experience, knowledge and familiarity with Desert Hot Springs, and also the programming and just the overall conciseness and completeness of the RFP. And with that being said, we are recommending Mizell to run the senior center, and I'd be happy to ask any questions.
Mr. McKee has a quick question. I'm going to open up for public comment, then I'll come back to council.
The quick question I have is go over the evaluation sheet again for Smooth Transitions. I just got on it, and I want to mark the things as they should be.
Sure. So on page 551, their overall score was a 92. So the experience with seniors slash community center operations, they received a 12 out of 15. And then also with the staff qualifications, they received an 8 out of 10. And that was based on their experience with senior centers. They've operated food programs in senior centers and other community centers. They actually haven't operated full operations control over a senior center. And then also the it's very similar with the staff qualifications. When I spoke to them, it was a matter of who was going to be there on a day-to-day operations, although, you know, they're probably a very fine person and very qualified. However, they actually haven't run a senior center.
Thank you. I'm going to open up to public comments. If anybody would like to speak on it, please come forth, state your name. Your 3 minutes will begin. Your time will be on the TVs behind me or monitors behind me.
Juanita Pinn, Desert Hot Springs. I'd just like to say that if you go with Mizell, we have a very poor income of seniors that are at our senior center. And Mizell does charge for a lot of their programs, even to be a member, at least in Palm Springs and the other ones they run. We need to figure out what we can do to help our poor seniors if they can't afford to pay for the services. I'm glad to see that maybe we are changing from FSA personally, because a lot of us seniors have been paying our own money to promote services for ourselves lately, and we shouldn't have to do that. I'd just like to suggest maybe a senior council so that you guys communicate with some of the seniors who attend so that you are aware of everything that goes on, because I really don't think you knew what was going on for the last few years. And we'd like to communicate with you. We want to work with you. We want to work with the seniors and whoever's in charge of us. We want them to communicate and want to listen to us, where we haven't been getting that. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Some fantastic ideas. Thank you so much. Anyone else like to speak to this? Yes, sir. State your name and your 3 minutes begin.
Ted Marhoffman, Desert Hot Springs, Mayor Mattis, Council, City Staff. I guess I wasn't going to speak on this, but I was asked to do something with one of the applicants that haven't been chosen, and I was going to, then I did some real research on the computer and decided not to. So I would recommend that you would go with the city staff's recommendation. Thank you.
Just state your name and your 3 minutes will begin.
Hi, my name is Kathy Kuzmich. I've lived in the community 15 months coming from Michigan. And I also volunteer over at St. Elizabeth's. And a lot of the people that I see go through the line at St. Elizabeth's are the same ones that come to the senior center. We have a very, I don't want to say poor class of people, but they're marginal. They don't have as much as some other people. And I know when I've gone over to my Zelle Center and when you walk in, you pay right away. There's not that friendly sort of attitude that we have over at the senior center, helping each other. So I don't know. I mean, I've seen change. We're on the senior advisory committee. I've been on since for about a year now. I have asked questions as to where the money goes that we collect for the ice cream fund or whatever else, and nobody can tell me. Nobody provides that to the senior advisory committee so that we can help run the senior center. I mean, when Mr. Betts first came to the center, I thought he was a driver. He didn't say who he was. I didn't know who he was. So, you know. Well, I mean, there's all kinds of people coming through there. And if you don't know, and I've only been here 15 months, so I don't know if Santa Claus came through and he wasn't wearing his red outfit. I'm not to know. But I'm just wanting to let you know that the people that are served at the senior center are poor people looking to try to stay at least one step ahead other than where they're at. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Well taken. Anyone else like to speak on this item? Second call? Final call? We'll go on to count.
We'd like to invite all of you to come have lunch with us and get to know us.
Absolutely.
We went up,
staff and I went up one day a couple months ago, and it was nice. We got to get there a lot more. You're absolutely right.
We don't know. There's people there that know your parents.
Yeah, you know? Probably so.
And there are some people there that don't know you.
Probably so. You would just think he was a Kansas City fan, right? Yeah. Your point well taken. Thank you, ladies. We're going to move on to council member comments. I agree with the staff recommendation. I also take into consideration the comments that have been made here tonight, and I agree that the advisory group needs to be put together so that they can be a liaison to the city council so we can hear what's going on there. I don't think a lot of us have been very happy with the services that have been going over there. Whether it was financial or our faults, we're not exactly sure at this point, but we need to have better services for our seniors at that center. After the tour that we took a couple months ago, I think we all saw it. So with this, and Mr. Betts does spend a lot of time over there representing the city. He's done a lot of work for the senior center, and he's brought back a lot of comments about what they do need over there. So it's all well taken, and I'll be supporting staff's recommendation tonight. Ms. Zavala. Ms. Zavala.
I want to thank you for your comments tonight, and I definitely do agree that we need to have some sort of advisory that communicates with the City Council to ensure that you're receiving the programs that you want to have and that you feel that you have the knowledge and information that you're supposed to have as the Senior Advisory Committee. I will say that in reading the supporting documentation for the three RFPs that came back, I will say that I do like my Zelle's, although it is more expensive and costly to the city. I feel that they had the greatest focus in terms of really understanding the senior community. I like the programs that they had. I like that they have affiliations with, you know, major hospitals like Desert Regional, JFK, and Eisenhower, and they connect with them to, you know, bring about nutrition classes to the senior community. And I just feel that they really have a senior center focus. So I really like that about them. And I do want staff to look into if there's going to be a fee associated with people participating in the various programs.
Well, yeah, I can tell you that the services that are being provided that are within the scope are supposed to be provided for free.
That's what I gather, because it's part of their proposal.
That's correct. Anything outside of that, like something that the seniors would request outside of what the scope is, could create some additional costs. But I'm wondering if the council would allow the senior group to meet directly with our assistant to the city manager. Mm-hmm. And that way we have the direct information instead of going all the way around the horn, and we can act on it more immediately.
Sounds like
a good
plan.
Yeah, sounds great. Mm-hmm. And just so that the public knows, right here, based on this RFP, they're including bingo and cards and other games and Wii bowling. They have the Meals on Wheels program. They have the health and nutrition classes that are actually presented by registered dietitians. They have social events for the major holidays. They're thinking of potentially having movie nights, and depending, I guess they want to gather information as to what you'd like to have there. So they even suggested maybe dances or potlucks or game days. They have arts and crafts classes like knitting and jewelry making and pastel art studio classes. So that's essentially what's on here in regards to what they're looking at providing.
Mr. McKee, ma'am, we can't go back and forth anymore. Sorry about that. Mr. McKee.
I'm unclear in some ways as to what is stuff that's going to be free and what is going to be chargeable, because I think, you know, it says additional events could be in the social events section, and I'm not sure whether that's going to be provided as a freebie or you're going to charge admission to the movies or whatever. The same thing goes with the arts and crafts classes. Under optional services, I assume all those are possibly things that are going to be chargeable. So if we could get something in the long run defining really what's happening, that would be helpful.
In addition to that, I think the ladies in their advisory group can also let Luke know if there's something outside of what is being paid for that they would like the city to consider.
Yeah,
I don't think any of the five of you would have an issue if we were to sponsor an event here and there directly related to the health and welfare or to the benefit of our seniors in addition to what our regular contract is.
I would agree with that, but just so we have a real clear idea of what's going to be provided under the contract and what is optional, I think that would be helpful. Thank you.
Mr. Betts?
Yeah, I think what's enumerated here on page 562 and 563 spells out what they're providing. They're showing it as a cost, so they've got to be, I can't believe, I didn't see any revenue projection in their budget here, so I can't imagine that they're going to be charging. They're not going to charge to get in the door. I think everything will be pretty much the same as you see now. If the mayor will allow the comment, then, Mr. Mayor, we have somebody itching to make a comment. How are you handling that?
Yeah, I'll open it back up. One more comment. You're going to have to come forth. I'm sorry, though, because the microphone has to record you.
They just were jumping out of their seat and...
Again, I'm Catherine Schoenfeld. I'm a retired RN. I was a member of MyCell. They are an excellent organization. I speak extremely highly of them. They have excellent fundraising, excellent amount of money coming in to be able to afford many programs that they provide for their folks over there. It's very true that over here we're totally different. We don't have a budget like that. The people that you're dealing with here are primarily concerned with the food. And the food is much better since they switched over to MyCell. I will say that, okay? MyCell has a program of membership for $25 a year. You can be a member, which is very, very reasonable. We don't have that here. That provides for a great number of programs that they have. They do charge for their art classes and things like that, but for members, it's very, very nominal. It might be $5 to $20 for X number of weeks for the art program, because I was a part of that. Over here, our bingo is free. You know, the folks over here are looking at a yearly income. I myself went from $56,000 a year to $18,061, so I think I can talk about that. It was because of health issues, but I do speak very highly of myself. I will tell you they are well organized, they are focused. Their chef, Chef Kelly, has a heart this big, and oftentimes when we have our meals at the senior center, if food is extra, sometimes we can have extra. It's an offer. But the suggested donation is $3 per meal. You're going to have a hard time with the folks in DHS being able to meet that. That would be about $90 a month. And when you do the math, it gets to be a little bit tight at $90 a month. I'm not complaining. Believe me, I'm not complaining, because I know the quality that you're dealing with my cell. And I will say that my cell is probably the best of the best. I'll leave that with you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Betts?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Okay, so, you know, I've talked to some of the people who aren't part of our senior center and also have the occasion to go down to Mizell, and I think we're going to see a really big improvement. And to all of you out there, I think this council, we know we're not Palm Springs, we know we're not Rancho Mirage, we're used to dealing with issues, whether it be Little League or whoever else. You know, parents don't walk in with all kinds of money to buy football uniforms and everything else. So, you know, we've taken the one field trip, we're taking some more. You know, if we got to go out and raise some private money for that, fine. But I don't think anybody here, I don't think there's anything in this contract that says when you walk in the door, you got to start paying. I think what you're going to see is a much more lively, better program. And I know the Community and Cultural Affairs Commission has taken an interest in the senior center and looking to organize stuff there. So I just think this is all around better deal. I'd like to make a motion to approve staff recommendation.
There's a motion and there's a second coming up on the screen. I think Mr. McKee and Ms. Zavala are going to fight over it. Mr. McKee doesn't have the energy right now. Any other?
Well, if it doesn't work out, we're in trouble.
Right? Any other comments? Please vote.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. Item number 18 is a loitering ordinance, and this is going to be our city attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. Kind of a correction for the record, even though it has it both in the staff report and on the agenda, it says a loitering ordinance. It's kind of a misnomer. Basically, with the ordinance that you have in front of you, really has to do with public safety and pedestrian safety, and I want to make that very, very clear for the record. You know, in such areas such as, you know, public highways, alleys, sidewalks, crosswalks, and in addition to that, we have we drafted a special section for the Carl May Center area, especially with respect to the driveways and the parking. What the ordinance does is it requires that people who use the Carl May Center, well, first of all, that people do not block, obstruct alleys, sidewalks, its streets for reasons. I mean, primarily it's due to vehicular traffic and safety, and we don't want people to get hit. And in addition, with respect to the Carl May Center, there's also we've had some issues dealing with people who've just, you know, standing and kind of blocking the driveways for no specific purpose other than to block a driveway and things like that. So we have seen those kinds of issues, and what the ordinance does. Excuse me, is it really kind of calls out, you know, for the safety of the citizens, the safety of the city as well. With that, the ordinance makes kind of any kind of violation, if you're just, you know, kind of blocking driveways, et cetera, of the Carl May Center, or standing, it's called standing and waiting, but kind of, you know, blocking access to alleys, sidewalks, streets, it makes it an infraction. It's not specifically stated in the ordinance, it's stated in the municipal code that the infraction for your first offense within the 12 first 12 months, the ticket is $100. The second offense within that same 12 months, the ticket is $200. And the third offense, the ticket is $500. And so it's not, we didn't make it a criminal aspect. It's an infraction for this. In addition, there's some cleanup language that we wanted to repeal section 10.36.050. It's superfluous. We kind of reworded it, made it in compliance with certain laws. And with that, if the City Council has any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Mr. Betts, you're in the queue.
Does this solve the problem that we've been having?
We hope so.
Chief,
I definitely hope so.
It will give us one more tool that we can use to help solve that problem.
Okay,
yes.
And then if this doesn't work, we're going to buy some speakers and blast polka music.
What was that? Why does it have to be polka music? I didn't hear you.
No, because only if you really
like polka music.
That's
polka
right.
Music.
But I don't think the demographic we're talking about is particularly excited about polka music. But okay. Anyhow, okay, great. Thank you,
Isabella.
I just wanted to bring up some areas of discussion that I had with the city attorney in regards to this ordinance. So in essence, if we have students that are out in the parking lot that are obstructing the parking lot, they'd, be asked to move. As of right now, if they are asked to move, we don't really have anything else to say other than please move. But if they don't, there's nothing we can do. So this is just, in essence, giving us an ability to actually be able to say, and I would hope that we use this in a manner where we issue a warning first before starting to cite students. Because, as with anything else, it's important to know what the rule is before you experience the consequence of it. So I do hope that, and I trust that that's what we will be doing, that we'll be warning students before finding them. And then the other thing that I did ask about was, in regards to ensuring that this doesn't go on their record. Mm-hmm. And that is something that was just clarified. So it's an infraction. It won't be on their record at all since it's not a misdemeanor, which was important to me. We want to make sure that, students aren't, bearing the brunt of their actions right now of, standing out on a parking structure or a parking lot and then seeing the effects of that later in life. I do kind of want to share a little bit about my personal experience. And it's important to remember that while some students, yes, are more prone to cause trouble, there are other students that are not, that are just simply young and they're out and it's after school and you don't really have time to really talk a lot at school because you're focused on school. So after school is when you really get to connect and have that ability to really express yourself. And I have personally had the experience when, even as a middle school student, of being escorted by a police officer off of the parking lot at Vons. And granted, I was a straight-A student. I was not by any means causing trouble, but I was hanging out with two friends. We were walking together, and of course we stopped. We would get something at McDonald's back when I would eat McDonald's, and or something at Subway or Vons. And, we just have to be mindful of the fact that those kinds of interactions do stick with you. I mean, if I'm here as a 27-year-old telling you about an experience that I had in eighth grade about feeling criminalized for simply being a citizen and a member of the community and going out and buying stuff and contributing to the economy, it can be a really demeaning experience. So I just want to make sure that we remember that these students are our future. And although they may look like they're causing trouble because they're hanging out with their friends, sometimes they're doing exactly that. They're hanging out with their friends. So I want to make sure that we are mindful of that because it isn't a nice feeling to be escorted from a parking lot. So just thought I would share that.
Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. There are two things I'd like to say. Could you go over that fine structure again? Because that isn't in our documentation at all.
No, it's not. And the reason why is many times when we draft ordinances, we just say this is the you know, it'll be charged as an infraction. And then frankly, in the very first chapter of the municipal code is where you have the fine structure. And so we don't, it, generally when we draft ordinances, we don't put that entire structure yet again.
Well, I'm concerned but at how quickly it escalates, sure. Though, too.
So what the fine structure currently is $100 for the first offense. And again, normally we do give a warning, and we work with the police department code to give a warning. But $100 for the first offense, with $200 for the second offense, but that has to be within a 12-month period. So that $200 has to be within 12 months of the first one. And $500 for the third offense within a 12-month period.
Can we, within this ordinance, change that fine structure?
No, it has not been noticed to change the fine structure, nor has it been drafted that way. Should the city council wish to change the fine structure, or because the fine structure applies to any infraction of the city, or to make a very specific fine structure for this ordinance, what we can do is we could come back for first reading again. Is it a public hearing? It's not a public hearing. But we come back for the first reading again, should the city council wish to change the fine structure specifically for this ordinance.
I would suggest that we should. I would suggest that we should, because even a $100 first fine for some families is going to be a killer, let alone if you get up to the $500
right.
For this, for trying to get a child to do what they should do. Now, I'm going to say a little bit about what I think Anaeli was talking about, and that is we have to, as a city council, over the next few months, years, deal with the fact that there aren't a lot of places for kids to hang out right now, that we don't have enough parks, we don't have enough space for them to deal with various things after they get out of school. And I think part of the problem we have here is you have a combination of air conditioning, restrooms, water, shade, and those sorts of things. So guess what? They're coming here to hang out because those are here and they can talk with their friends. So it's important, I think, from my standpoint, that we also look at the fact that we're not providing in a lot of ways the services that we should in an environment that they're not going to get into trouble. That's basically all I had. I just wanted to talk about the fine structure, because I think it should probably start at $50, go to $100, and the third one being $200 or something like that. Just because, you know, families, if you're having trouble buying groceries and your kid just got a $100 fine, that is a big deal. So thank you.
I got Mr. Betts, Ms. Parks, and I'm going to open up for public comment. Mr. Betts.
Okay, first off, I think the officer has the discretion in this ordinance to issue a warning or not, and to let somebody know you just got a $100 fine if you do this again. I want to correct the council members here, comments. This isn't just about people hanging out. I can appreciate having a place to hang out. This is about behavior while hanging out. And it's been a very, very serious problem, especially in this facility. It includes the county having to hire two guards. It includes the people over in that building and the senior center saying they feel intimidated. These are adults. People back here have probation experience saying that they feel intimidated. Fights, you go on YouTube and see them. And from my personal experience, me to the point where I got to call the police, as big as I am, because there's three of them, got me backed into a corner. Unfortunately, there was another resident came over and started filming, and apparently them being filmed put them on notice that at least we got them ID'd, and so, you know, I don't back down real easy, but it was a very intimidating situation, and I know the mayor had a problem, or I'm sorry, the mayor pro tem had a problem when she tried to pull into the handicapped parking. So I appreciate the comments about kids needing a place and everything else. If they were just hanging out here and the nice, friendly people and saying hello and hi, can I hold the door open for you, or, you know, being respectful, that's one thing. That's not what we've got going on here. So I'm not real interested and being, with all the problems we've had, being soft and saying, oh, well, you know, geez, $100 is a tough problem for a parent. I hope the parent will say, wow, you're going to get a $100 fine. You better shape up. Now, if that doesn't happen, I don't know what else to do. I don't know if this is all going to work. But I'm not completely without compassion for kids trying to find stuff to do. But the ones that are out there didn't seem to me to have a conscience when it came to some of these issues and or a good moral constitution. And they need to get some shaping up. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Mayor Pro Tem Parks, and then I'm going to go to public comments, and I'll come back to council.
Okay, one question. You stated that the fines are a part of the municipal code. So if we change the fine structure, we'll have to change our municipal code?
Yes, but what we can do is we can keep the infraction as 100, 200, 500 for general infractions, and then for this specific ordinance, we could actually make, change the fine structure just for this specific code section, if that makes sense. If that's something council,
if that's what we decide,
if that's council,
as a majority,
correct.
Yeah.
This helps deal with the people standing in the medians, also.
What was that?
Stand in the medians.
Correct.
I think is very unsafe.
Yes.
Asking for
medians, money. Alleys, streets, any kind of public right of way.
Public comments. Please state your name and your 3 minutes will begin.
Hi, my name's Kathy Kusminch again. I've worked with kids for 50 years, and the one thing I know is you're going to find a kid. The kid ain't paying it. The parents are. Community service or some kind of action that the child has to participate in is going to learn something. If the parent pays $100, $200, $500, I don't know what you're going to do with the kid after $500 if the parents are just going to pay off the kid. You need some kind of interaction between the child and the incident. I mean, that's logic. Working with kids, they understand when they have to put out, they don't want to. So they change. Thank you.
Thank you.
Or the parents, what?
State your name and.
Hello, I'm Sue Hiron. I'm with the Girl Scout and Boy Scout Troop 1606 NILA. Thank you very much for sharing that story. If there's one thing that I can tell you, it is that youth who need the love the most will ask for it in the most unloving ways. To fine a child, even a teenager, $100 for their behavior, I know in some circumstances that would help. One thing that we've seen time and time again in this community is that that behavior starts at home. It isn't just that they come out into public and decide to bully people over into the corner. Most of those kids are being treated that way at home. Right. And I hate to say that, but that's true. When you start putting fines to it, their punishment goes up at home. A lot of the kids that we have, they will show up anytime, any place that we ask them to do anything because they don't have a home life that they want to go home to. A lot of them are afraid to go home. Community service, just like she said, we will take any of them in. If you can word it any way, to where at least on their first offense, maybe even their first two, sometimes it takes three or four to break that attitude down. Put an amount of hours with it. Send them over to us. You guys know where we're at Sundays. We don't mind overseeing them. We don't mind putting them in a program. The kids here will work. Every single one of them will work to benefit this community. It teaches them something different. It breaks down those walls. It teaches them responsibility. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Ted Merhoffen, I'm glad you guys are working on this because it's been an ongoing problem for at least 10 years. In fact, I won't even take any classes over here next door because of the problems that have been going on here. In the time that I was next door, the security guard there spent 45 minutes sitting inside the class lab over there, as opposed to being out patrolling around. He spent 15 minutes in the hour I was there outside. My next question is how are you going to collect the money? Thank you.
Next speaker, please.
Getting used to this. Catherine Schoenfeld, retired RN. I live at Second and Palm, and I appreciate your comments, I really do. I go to the senior center probably every day. We're talking about breaking of windows, where now we have plywood over the window. I was there one day when the group outside of the senior center was very intimidating, and I stayed deliberately so that Maria would not be there alone. And I said, please make a phone call for a community service call to the local police department so that they know it's not a 911 issue, but we need the presence. That presence was a great deterrent. I know you can remember, and I appreciate your comments, I really do. Living at Second and Palm, which is right across from the South of the Border restaurant, there is a bus stop directly across from where I live, okay? There is a gentleman who's been there over a month, and I'm not saying anything against him or the homeless. Please do not misunderstand me. But when I come out my front door, the first thing I see is that bus stop. I can't even come out and have a cup of coffee in the morning with just sitting there and enjoying the pool without this man sitting there watching everything I do, from getting my scooter ready to go to the senior center, to taking care of the cat. I mean, every little detail he watches, and he sits there for hours, okay? We have called, he's moved out, he goes down the street for a while, and then he comes back. What is the time limit on this loitering? What stipulates loitering time-wise? I don't want to see anything bad happen to this person. I don't want to see anything bad happen to me. The rumor is that he has a record, that he was a molester. I don't know the truth of that. I haven't investigated it because I don't have the courage to go up to him and engage him in conversation to find out what is going on in your life. I don't want to know. Okay? I leave that with you. That's just the flip side, okay? We have to have compassion. I do agree with the community service thing. I mean, you get somebody out there weeding a yard, what kid in the world at any age wants to weed a yard? You know what I'm saying? Or plant flowers by the side of the road, or plant trees, or do something that is constructive that breaks that home situation that she was talking about. Because there's so much of that here. And we have so many people coming out of prison that are deposited. We have over 60 pedophiles on 2nd Street and 3rd Street and 4th Street alone. I've got the documentation at home if you want to see it. That's scary. And that's all I want to say. Thank There's you. A flip side.
Thank
okay?
you very much.
All right.
All right. Any other public Thank comments tonight? Second call, final call. Close public comments. We're going to go back to council member comments. I didn't get a chance to make one, so I'll do mine, and then I'll go back around. I understand all sides of it. I get it. Community service is probably something that we'd love to put in effect rather than fines, because fines probably won't be paid. If there's a program to do it, the way to do it, then I'd like to at least explore it with staff and see if there's a possibility with it. The kids that are running around here causing problems are bad kids. And they're probably less than 5% of the kids in our population, but they just happen to be the loudest. And unfortunately, they're making the most damage. My biggest concern in the community with this loitering ordinance was getting people off the medians, because I think it's very unsafe and it doesn't give a good representation to what our city is about. And they cause vandalism to our medians. If you go there and you see, they've dug up holes, they've left their trash, and it's not a good look for our community. So I think overall, I think there's a lot of good comments that have been made tonight. I think staff's got a great direction on where to go with this. I think we need to adopt it, and I think staff understands our concerns. Then I think they'll implement some sort of programming here that will help meet our comments tonight. All right, second round, Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I sort of feel accosted as being a bleeding heart when in fact, I was probably leading the charge as far as dealing with getting the school district, getting this county, getting some of the other things going on as far as trying to take care of the problem. My point is, number one, they aren't all bad kids. There are kids that are doing stupid things. I can remember when I was a teenager, I did stupid things. There are some that are bad. But the issue you have, in some cases, these sorts of systems get both bad and good tangled up in them. And my feeling is that if you have this structure in place where you're charging this much, 90% of the people in the city aren't even going to pay it. Mm-hmm. They're just going to say, why am I going to pay that? what are we going to do then? So, and then what happens? That's more and more costs for us. So the key, as far as I'm concerned, is what we've done in the past. We put the bus stop over by the Health and Wellness Center. That got about half the people out of the situation. We started making sure that we had the proper sort of people around here, keeping them under control. But even today, when I came in, there were probably 40 kids standing around. Most of them were not doing anything. They weren't bad kids. But you had somebody over here messing around with a skateboard. Well, it says, don't use a skateboard here. Should we have the chief run somebody over and grab them for that? I mean, what we want to do is fix the problem. And if someone believes that this is going to have more effect than what we've done even so far, I think you're banking up the wrong tree. I think it's going to help some, but the ultimate solution is getting them away from here, because they're using the parking lot and this space is areas where they're hanging out. They're not coming here to hassle anybody. They're coming here initially because they have the ability to hang out here. And that's the problem I have. Until we can put all these structures in place and say, okay, we're going to do this, and we're going to have 100 people out here running around chasing them off, and we're going to fine them if they're here and everything else. If they don't have any place to go, they're just going to continue coming here and being the same problem. At least that's my feeling.
And not to debate with you, but I'm going to. We, you know, our community has programming, and there's a lot of good programming out there, and maybe it's a better job we need to do as a city on getting that information out to the schools and stuff. I know we do need a lot of upgrades. I mean, our parks and space is limited, and we need more programs, but a lot of times they're just being lazy and not looking for the programs. Or I shouldn't say lazy. I'm getting tired. I'm not using the proper terminology, but there's the Boys and Girls Club. There's the Health and Wellness Center. There's multiple Boy Scout, Girl Scout programs in our community. There's, you know, the list can go on. But, you know, I understand what you're saying, but I also think we have to push back on the parents a little bit on putting their kids in the programs that are needed. Yeah. So, Ms. Zavala.
Just going and touching back in regards to programming, I do think it's an important area of focus, and I realize that we do have programs like the Scouts and we have the Boys and Girls Club, but sometimes at this age, kids age out of these sorts of programs. They're at a point now where I studied psychology, so they're trying to figure out their identity, and they're trying to figure out how they are becoming their own adult and their own person. So in these kinds of spaces, they don't really have somebody telling them what to do, you know, which is something that they're used to the entire day when, you know, your teacher's telling you what to do, your security guard's telling you what to do, the principal's telling you what to do, your parents tell you what to do. Everybody around you is telling you what to do. So these are the times when they feel that they have that autonomy over themselves. And we do realize that nobody is debating whether, nobody's saying that all of them are, you know, innocent little angels, because, you know, we all know that we can all get in trouble. We're just saying that we want to make sure that we're not casting out a net so big that everybody's getting caught underneath. And I do think it's fair to have repercussions for your actions if you're not following the rules. I think repercussions are important. We just also want to make sure, you know, I did make sure to ask that if they're, you know, sitting here and under the shade, that that's okay as long as they're, you know, not in the parking lot, because we do lack shading structure over on the bus stop. And I think as a city council, we also have to work with Sunline to make sure that we expand the shading structure out there. And I see Chuck has something to say.
I just think we're getting a little lost in what's going on here. I think what's happening is the chief put it perfectly. This is another tool. The intention of the police department, and I know the leadership of the police chief, he's not going to say, okay, guys, I'm going to unleash you all on everybody over there and write as many tickets as humanly possible. The idea is that we've had some significant issues here beyond just, you know, what we've been discussing tonight. We've had criminal offenses here. We've had brandishings of weapons here. We had an attempt homicide here one time. So with all that being said, now those are crimes in and of themselves, but if we don't impact the broken windows up front somehow, then we continue to have those larger issues later on. So the chief said it, and I said, again, I have to reiterate that, this is just another tool. That doesn't mean that it's going to be utilized as the only option that they have. I know that they use good common sense. I realize that we're hiring the best and the brightest these days. He is socializing them on a regular basis so they understand what his vision and direction is. And I think when they get out here and they have this tool, it'll be used as a last resort, not something that is the first thing out of the quiver. So I want to make sure that that's understood. And if we really thought that we could impact the situation with some of those who are going to be written a citation. We're not talking about kids that are using shade, skating on their skateboards. The chief over here, I'll give you a good example. He had one of these kids doing circles around him, calling him everything but late for dinner, and he took the kid's skateboard and he says, you can have your mom come over and get it. They never showed up. He still has a skateboard. But I'm saying he takes other options to control some of the issues here. And I think when it gets to a point where you've got a habitual, constant problem that has not been cannot be addressed with other means, this is what he wants to be able to put into place.
Yeah, no, and I completely understand that. And like I said, I do see the importance of having those consequences in place for, you know, people that are not abiding by the rules. However, I do also want to see us work towards expanding that shading structure for the bus stop and seeing what potential other options we may have, if we could improve our parks, or maybe if even possible in the future at some point, build a park that's closer to the school where they can just go there before they get here, or, you know, just something like that, so that, you know, we're giving them an alternative in essence, that so that they don't feel like this is the only place where they can go that's close enough to hang out. So that's it. And as far as the fee structure, I feel that I think for just this specific one, I do like Joe's idea of just for this specific infraction, having a lower fee structure would be great. And just so that we make sure that we actually collect the payment. And then, and if possible, if we could tie it into volunteer service, I think that would be great, because it is important to for a student to actually do something to rectify their behavior. I'm not sure if that's something that we can do, but if we can, that'd be great. Maybe we could collaborate with the school district to where they have to do their community service with the school district or something like that.
Mr. Betts?
On the bus stop, if you want to expand that, that's Sunline provides a basic shelter, and cities can elaborate on that all they want to. But I think if you're going to create a bigger bus shelter, you're going to have kids hanging out in the bus stop, and that may be a problem there. Sunline already has that issue with the bus stops in town, so we've got to be careful on that one. You know, if they are good kids, the potential of a fine is going to be a deterrent. Community service, I think, is something that's ordered by a judge, if I'm not mistaken, and that's not something that we can just go and say hi without adjudicating it. You're going to go serve community service. That's usually in lieu of a some other civil or criminal penalty, and we didn't want to go that far. You know, the city manager said it pretty clearly. You're giving our police another tool to try and start to correct this problem. And, you know, that this statement was made, they're not coming here to harass people. Yes, some of them are. If they are harassing people, that's exactly what they came here to do, is harass people. You don't make it as, you don't go harass people just because all of a sudden you're like, well, I'm going to go. It's a conscious decision you make to harass people. It's an attitude, and they're doing it here. And you got adults that are afraid to go walk in this facility. We're just making more out of this step, I think, than what's intended here. This is just a first step in trying to solve the problem. Go ahead and do all those other youth programs, everything else you want to do. But right now we got an immediate problem here. And if you don't want to do with this, do it this way. Come up with something else. I don't think you need to go bending the fee structure that's set in the municipal code. I think we got officers here that are capable of determining when some kid is doing something serious enough that, you know, you're going to get a $100 fine, and, you know, it may just get their parents' attention. You know, if you can get them all down, if you get them all down to your, you know, troops, the scouts, come round up all these kids and get them to go down to your meetings and put them in a structured environment and solve this problem, have at it. But as far as I'm concerned, if people are afraid to go to that library, people will not use that library right now. And I have more compassion for the people that want to use the library and the seniors that want to go to the senior center than I do for some kids that want to get adults cornered so that they can intimidate them to the point where you got to call the police to get out of it. So I make a motion to approve staff recommendation.
Is there a second?
With the amount set.
Second.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council.
Hold on 1 second. I have one more council member, then I'll come to the city attorney. Councilmember Parks.
Yeah, I just want to see, originally, when we had all of these kids out here, their excuse was, well, we have to come over here because this is where we have to catch the bus. So Sunline went out of their way to give them an option to catch the bus right there on Cholla. Do you think that they want to catch the bus there? No, they want to come over here and hassle. So there's got to be some way to deter that, because the purpose for them coming over here is not to catch a bus, because they can catch a bus over there on Cholla. So why are they coming over here? To cause trouble.
City attorney.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I just wanted to correct myself. Two things. The ordinance, I did want to kind of come back to the mayor's point where it you were concerned about the medians. As written, I don't call out medians. It calls out public highways, alleys, sidewalks, etc. Should the council wish to adopt the ordinance, I would like to add the word median just to make sure. And I misspoke. If there are changes, we could do it now, and it could still come back for second reading. I got confused. So thank you.
Commissioner Betts, would you add that?
I thought that was the motion with the median.
Thank you very much. All right. With that said, I have nobody else in the queue. No, now I do. Ms. Savala.
I feel like we didn't really get an answer in regards to the community service.
The motion on the table is to continue with the fine structure as directed by staff and to approve the staff recommendation. Is that correct, Mr. Betts?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Do you have anybody else in the queue? Please vote.
Motion passes with Council Members Zavala and McKee opposed. And this is a first reading of an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Desert Hot Springs, amending the Desert Hot Springs Municipal Code by 1, adding Article 6, obstruction of pedestrian traffic prohibited, 2, adding Article 7, Carl May Center parking lot and driveways use restrictions, and 3, repealing Section 10.36.7 050, unreasonable interference with free passage of pedestrians of Title 10 vehicles in traffic. The ordinance will return on February 7th for second reading.
Thank you very much. Our last item of the night is number 19, construction tentative improvements at 11999 Palm Drive Visitor Center. Public Works Manager Daniel Porras.
Mr. Mayor, before we get into that, I believe this is the Visitor Center, correct?
This is. So yes. You'll need to recuse
yourself. As I'm measured from our salon at 12106 and a half Palm Drive, I'm within 500 feet, so I'll recuse.
Thank and you me. Can take the rest of the night off.
No, don't let him go home.
Make him come back, yeah, for the adjournment of the meeting.
Yes, if we have to stay, yes.
Mr. Public Works Manager, thank you for hanging out with us all night. This is your item.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the council. This item regarding the construction of tenant improvements at 11999 Palm Drive, that is the Visitor Center. That's the northwest corner of Palm and Pearson. City staff completed analysis of administrative office space available and necessary to complete all city businesses. We took into account total number of staff, number of available offices, current and for future, the cost of building maintenance, the cost of the required building improvements, cost of tenant improvements, cost of purchasing land, and cost of leasing and renting buildings. The first one we analyzed was the current City Hall complex, located on 65950 Pearson Boulevard. City Hall is currently made up of three main buildings. Each building is made up of individual temporary modular buildings. All three overall buildings are in need of major infrastructure improvements. Some of those improvements include frame and structure reconstruction and restabilization, the complete re-roofing, new ADA compliance features, re-leveling of the building floors, adjusting the door frames, window frames, etc., removing some of the warp damage floors. There's some ACs that need to be replaced or are in their last time that are going to be needed to be replaced in the near future. And there's also some electrical and plumbing upgrades that will need to be done to bring them up to current building codes. Staff completed a preliminary cost estimate for those improvements. Building A was estimated at $512,000. Building B was $314,000. Building C was $216,000. Those are all shown in Exhibit 1. Staff also went on and analyzed the ongoing building maintenance cost and came up with the conclusion that due to the exceeding the building life of the existing temporary buildings, each year we're increasing our cost to maintain them at the level that they are right now. Currently, every single office and cubicle is being used for storage or for use of staff members. Some offices are even used by dual staff members. We even have a staff member in the counter currently. We also analyzed buying open property or leasing and renting existing buildings that fit our needs. After all this analysis was done, the staff recommends that the most feasible option was determined to be the relocation of the city's administrative offices to the existing building located at 11999 Palm Drive, which is the Visitor Center. Currently, the Visitor Center is a building that is owned by the city. All of that surrounding the Visitor Center are owned by the city, so there's a big financial savings there. The first phase of the City Hall relocation would entail completing interior tenant improvements, which that means is we will be installing some interior divider walls, interior doors, a new entryway, some electrical data upgrades, HVAC and lighting adjustments, and other office upgrades that are necessary to convert the existing building into an administrative building. With that, city requested proposals from qualified contractors, received two proposals. One of them was from Diamond Construction. The total amount of that was $157,140.00. The second one was from Nickel Construction in the amount of $163,825.00. Staff reviewed the proposals for completeness, verified references, reviewed past project performances with similar projects, and verified licenses and insurance. Based on that analysis, staff is recommending that City Council authorize the City Manager to execute a contract with Diamond Construction for the construction of tenant improvements at 11999 Palm Drive in the amount of $157,407 with a 20% contingency amount of $31,494.00. The 20% contingency amount was added after the fact The only reason we added a large contingency was because we took a second tour of the building and we realized that the entry point for the phone and data is actually at the exterior of the building currently. So we are going to need to relocate that to the interior of the building. The building used to be a bank a while back, and it's on the exterior of the vault. So we will need to remove that and relocate it to the interior of the building where it's temperature controlled and could be accessible by staff for maintenance. On your exhibits, you have a estimated preliminary cost of the improvements. You have the bid comparison, both bids, and a proposed new floor plan. With that, staff is recommending that City Council authorize City Manager to execute a contract with Diamond Construction Incorporated for the construction of tenant improvements at 11999 Palm Drive in the amount of $157,407.00 with a 20% contingency of $31,494 for unforeseen expenses, which brings the total budget amount to $188,964.00. That concludes my staff report. I'm glad to answer any questions.
Any public comments? I see no one getting up. We'll close public comments. Mr. McKee.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First clarification, we're moving the visitor center portion still to the entrance to this building, at least temporarily, so that will be reinstituted. And I can tell our hoteliers that every month they can quit beating me up.
I've already told them that they can provide some brochures at that location as well.
Okay.
They still continue to beat you up?
They will about something else now. At least it'll be something new. It's interesting to me that the total amounts from the two construction companies, first of all, it's great that they're both local companies. I'm glad that they're both Desert Hot Springs companies. But what concerns me is, although the amounts are very close to one another, they're, you know, about, what, $5,500 difference, there are some significant differences in the specific things that they're talking about doing. For example, on number 13, which is construction in the calendar.
What page are you on?
I'm on page 585, sorry.
Thank you.
On the construction of the counter, number 13, Diamond says it's going to cost $1,200, and Nickel says it's going to cost $16,000. If you go down further, construction of cabinets, Diamond says the cabinets are going to cost $33,000, and Nickel says $7,100. And you go down through the whole thing, and there are huge swings back and forth. Construction of exterior glass storefront. Diamond says $15,500. Nickel says $3,100. Those are massive differences for things. And that really just makes me nervous looking at that sort of thing. Are we really comfortable that we gave these people the proper specifications and they understood what was going on?
Yes, this is actually, those line items were lump sum items. Each company, I asked the exact same question, each company has their own estimating software that they use, so it separates it a little bit different than our bid items. So if you look at maybe 70% of these are lump sum, they are all grouped together in their software, but in our line item, it's a little bit different. At the end of the day, all the lump sums are lump sum. The each items are the ones that we can are based on either one door, two doors, two windows, whatever it is. But the rest of them are lump sum. They were within 4%, which is fairly accurate for at least the specs on the entire building. So we do feel comfortable that it's a solid number for that one.
Okay, that's actually a good explanation. Thank you, Daniel.
Is that it? I don't have anybody else in the queue. No, there it is. Ms. Zavala.
So just one quick comment, and just so that the public knows, in essence, doing this is actually cheaper than trying to continue to throw money into fixing our non-permanent current City Hall build. Yeah, exactly. They were actually meant to be temporary, but we've never gotten to the point where we need to put in money into them to continue using them, and they're not permanent structures. So this is actually a better use of the money, and it's cheaper. And with that, I'd like to make a motion to approve and authorize the city manager to execute a contract with Diamond Construction, Inc. for the construction of tenant improvements at 11999 Palm Drive in an amount of $1,507,000 with $157,000, $470 yeah. with zero cents. With a 20% contingency amount. Okay. You get the point. Approve it.
Numbers will come tomorrow when you wake up again.
I know. When I wake up.
I have a motion and a second. No further discussion. Please vote.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you very much. I have nothing else on the agenda tonight. We are adjourned.
Thank you for hanging around.